Welcome to an astonishing moment in the history of architecture and design, a truly historic moment when we're bringing together some of the leading designers and architects in the world to discuss the implications of AI on that world. Today, we are delighted to have some of the most significant figures that we have exploring this new terrain. I'm starting against the backdrop of another historic moment, the moment when arguably symbolically, architecture met AI, or AI met architecture, when with this installation, the projection by Refik Anadol of this data sculpture onto Frank Gehry's design for the Walt Disney Concert Hall, symbolically, suddenly, the world of deep learning, the world of neural networks met architecture. Within a year of this astonishing installation, Refik had generated what is arguably the first ever StyleGAN-based generated design for architecture, and the rest, as it were, is history. But it's been a very rapid history. We're talking from 2019 effectively until now, and in the last 9 months especially, we have suddenly seen an explosion of interest in AI. All of a sudden, architecture has met AI. I gave a lecture at the AA back in May of last year, and I was asking, when will our architects finally wake up to it? When will this moment be? And Patrick Schumacher was in the audience and said, it's already here. We've been collaborating with Refik Anadol on a version of DALL-E 2 before it had been released, and they had already done some astonishing sort of work. Since then, all of a sudden, things have changed in an astonishing new way. So today, I'm delighted to be able to bring together some very, very distinguished panelists. The intention today is to have some very short 5-minute presentations of their work to give you a sense of how AI has been explored in the world of design, and then to have a roundtable discussion to discuss the implications of this astonishing new world. Let me just give you a little brief burst of the music that went with this astonishing installation that was going to happen in LA back in 2000. So today then marks the final moment in the series, an introduction to AI for designers. We've had tutorials, we've had Petra Kuchas, we've had lectures and so on. And this is the final moment, the crescendo, the end in the UK on Guy Fawkes Night. We always end with this kind of spectacular crescendo. And today then, this is it. This is the final moment when we bring together everyone. I'm not going to say much in terms of introductions to those to our speakers today, because they are so famous. Their reputation precedes them. But we will start with Patrick Schumacher, who has been not only the CEO of the director of Zaha Hadid Architects, but also a real pioneer in pushing the boundaries of how we can engage with computation in the world of design. We'll follow with Refik Anadol, who has been collaborating, as I mentioned, with that office, and who himself is a rock star within the world of new media. Refik Anadol from Turkey, he came to LA back in 2012, and since then he's set the world on fire with the work that he's been producing. We then move on to someone who is within the world of industrial design is on an equal par, Ross Lovegrove, someone who has been an inspiring figure for years, a very close associate of Patrick Schumacher. I first came across Ross in the Leighton Utopias exhibition, which I think was 2000 or something in Austria. And Ross has been exploring the potential of this extraordinary new world as well. And then if we're going to use the term rockstar, maybe the term rockstar applies to Michel Rofkin, because not only is he the rockstar of Mexican architecture, but he actually was a rockstar or a musician before he embarked on his astonishing architectural career or design career. I recall seeing him, showing him that SIARC is a new design for a football. Astonishing work that is coming out from Michel. Michel joined us today from Spain. Then we have Wan Yu He, who is the CEO of XCool. Wan Yu worked for Rem Koolhaas for 8 years. XCool equals XCoolhaas. And she has been at the forefront of developing AI software for architecture and is really, I think, leading the show, operating from Shenzhen in China. And finally, we have Daniel Bolajan, who is both one of the leading AI and architecture experts in his own right, exploring it in his field as a professor at Florida Atlantic University. But also he is the kind of the brains behind or the genius behind the core Himmelblau initiative, Deep Himmelblau. And Daniel will be showing us some of the work that he's been that they're doing in the office today. So I'm going to unshare my screen, and I would like to invite Patrick to kick things off with a short description of a 5-minute presentation of the kind of work that we're doing. And then once we've been through the presentations, we'll have this discussion about the future, the potential of AI for the world of design. So welcome, Patrick.
Hi, guys. Well, happy to be here and ready for the discussion. I will share my screen in a minute. I just want to mention, actually with Refik's invitation, we got really going with AI on DALL-E 2. And we actually started before DALL-E 2 came out. And when DALL-E 2 came out, it kind of shifted the possibilities, I think. And I finally got convinced in the incredible fertility and creative potential of these tools, when they reach that quality where you can really work away from that and use as a tool of ideation, which we're doing ever since. And I will show. I start with the first series we developed when Refik allowed us to, he was an early adopter and early invited user of DALL-E 2, that he allowed us into that. And so I show some of the results of this, which I still think stunning, and we haven't worked through that catalog to exploit. In the meantime, since then, we have Midjourney account, and we're using it for early ideation, and I will show some recent examples of that as well. Just want to mention that, of course, in terms of, let's say, under the larger umbrella of AI, we use machine learning algorithms and neural networks to learn more kind of rational module-based configuration optimization. Let's say it's probably more similar to CoolX. We also use that in some of our research teams and for instance, corporate interior, where you have a lot of permutations and you can use measures against to optimize. And I'm currently working also on, and Neil know that, on optimizing using neural network to test for legibility, orientation, navigation, etc. in complex spaces. But for this session, I thought just to show the ideation kind of power of these new tools and the way we've been using them. So let me find the right screen to share. I think, yeah, we're here. So you'll see that, and I've just kicked that off like this. Wait. What are you looking at?
Four screens, you have to do full screen.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying here, but it doesn't.
Okay.
Wait. I think I have another presentation open, that's why. Ah, okay, yeah, now I understand. To kick that off. Sorry about that glitch. Yeah, so I just rapidly rush through these. Earliest exploration where
Patrick, it's not
full screen. Moving. God.
No, okay, wait. Sorry.
Okay. Wait, I know how to fix that. Wait. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Let's see. Now it works, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. So just showing some of the kind of search space, and you get these kind of 10 images, and not everything is usable, but there are at least often one or two great sketches one could use to take forward, obviously. And we did this in the collaboration with Refik and also for the show in Seoul, where we picked some of them and modeled them, modeled the exterior, modeled interior, and also obviously the way you use the probes, a lot of the interiors are coherent with possible exteriors. And that's something we still kind of wanted to push forward more, to get front, back, sides, and interiors in a more coherent set. That's something we're hoping is coming. But I still remain mesmerized by, and this is about, let's say, at least 10-15% of the output, which I'm showing you here, and generated about 150 potentially great projects. And oftentimes they have interesting ideas and new kind of formal moves, and they're you know, you can show them as early sketches even to clients. And yes, we get called out sometimes recently about that, that you don't even have to do much. You show them raw, and you can show generate ideas and share ideas with clients and within the team, because if light, shadow, geometry, coherency, the sense of gravity and order is so potent. And the ideas are still striking. I mean, the repertoire, and this is just one kind of sequence, let's say, of our work, where it's more concrete based and GRC kind of based complex cultural projects as a kind of backdrop for that production here. And as I said, Refik might show how some of that got utilized, and we then kind of 3D modeled it and run animations against it. And these things are so coherent, I think, and they're so kind of meaningful that it's easy to model them because they have that three-dimensional implied coherency. And now I know there's many people working on the direct 3D integration, and we have a collaboration with Emmanuel Co on that one. He's making steps forward on that. And we're also trying to build our own kind of repertoire of models and using Stable Diffusion to build to try to get into this as well. So we have our kind of AI research, small research group as well internally. But again, I think this catalog here is yet to be exhausted in terms of exploitation, and we continue to generate that. As I said, I will show you the end some Midjourney work. So we have this Discord channel, and we selected, we having a corporate license, but everybody who's working can see everybody else's, and we have project numbers, and not every single project is using it, but all the, let's say, most of the, I'm encouraging everybody who's working in competitions and early ideation to see what comes up, and just to have a larger repertoire. And for me, it's always been very similar to verbal prompting teams, referencing prior projects and ideas on gesticulating, you know, with my hands. That's the way of kind of generating ideas, and I can do that now directly with Midjourney or DALL-E 2, or the team can do it as well on our behalf, and so I think that's been quite potent. So I think, yes, I don't want to go into details, but basically what I'm saying here with all of these sketches, most of them, nearly all of them, have a kind of Zaha Hadid in the prompting with various kind of attributes and programmatic suggestions, etc. I accept all of that into our oeuvre, as you know, or any of them, what comes out of this, I feel claim authorship for it in terms of validating, selecting, elaborating. So I feel very kind of empowered by all this possibility. And so these are just one shot sketches, just exploring that medium in a frantic kind of few days. And then since then, as I said, we have systematic, we have on the one hand, we have Stable Diffusion, we want to, in the end, build our own network and run on our own server. We have a big server farm in our data center. And then also we're using Midjourney, as I said, and I'll show you, we're using it for early ideation, for generating ideas for competition. And let me just accelerate this forward to get to that point. And you can see here, I'm very interested in these complex interiors and the resolution of complex compositions. So this was DALL-E 2. This is early experiments with Stable Diffusion. And again, it's quite similar. Always the Zaha Hadid is in the prompt. And these are the Midjourney things. Midjourney is a kind of particular style. And this is not always using Zaha Hadid. This is always using kind of, no, this is, let's say, you can guess where this is going in terms of, this is Neom kind of ideation for various projects. There's so many for something which is, you know, landscape related, desert related, citadel kind of urban configurations, or resort kind of fields and villages and hotels, etc. So these are the programs we've been looking at. And here you can see in the systematic exploring, all these are for single project, for ideation for one project, and we're homing in on something which we've then developed further. I mean, this particular project didn't go forward, but I thought it was quite potent concept we could work with. So this is now kind of, let's say, in a context, not playing around, project specific, context and landscape specific, programmatic specific, and then iterating and seeing multiple and many of those options, and then picking up one and working through with them, and but also sharing already with the client. You know, you're very fast, and I think that's and they didn't mind, you know, so they be part of a creative process easier this way. This becomes, I think, quite potent. So yeah, this is this series, and I will just show you at the end because I'm running out of time. Obviously, the attempt, what I'm trying to say, interior and exterior, how do you make it coherent? So what I've done here is actually I initially started with this image, an atrium with tectonism, this exoskeleton in the atrium, mega atrium with exoskeleton, and then using that image and marry it and merge it with another project, which is a multi-tower complex we had to work at the moment developing in Hong Kong for Austin Road, for instance, and then fusing this and generating something so that I in the end have something which where the exterior and interior are credibly connected, and you can develop a project more coherently using these tools. So with that, I hand over. I think I'm excited about this. These are just generated yesterday, for instance. And so we are onto it, and we really hope for the next stage where everybody's working on 3D options for that one. Okay, I stop sharing here.
Great, exciting.
Thanks, Patrick. That was astonishing. So Refik is now currently in New York. Refik, it'd be great would you like to share your screen?
Yes, absolutely. First of all, a truly deep honor and privilege, first of all, with Patrick diving into a tool together. And it's so historic. I mean, it's only 2 years, but it feels like 20 years. It's as I'm still processing, like we were. But I think it's a beautiful moment, I guess, for any creator, hopefully, and especially young generations who are hopefully just learning about generative AI. But I'm happy to say that thanks to Patrick and our exploration, I think probably the very first time a generative AI in architecture, but not only just visual, we also made a physical space. I want to show what happened after that. I think also very exciting. So just for everyone, I think I was, of course, I mean, Zadid Architects, Frank Gehry. I mean, I've been as an artist admiring the architecture as a form of artistic exploration. And respectfully, when I was experimenting as an MFA student at UCLA, Design Media Arts, this was the first experiment in a public space trying to see how the canvas of the building as a skin can turn into this one day a surface that can hopefully use for architectural intelligence. So in 2016, started my residency at Google AMI. And back in time, Blaise Agora Arcas and Mike Taika and Texo Kerrick McDowell as a curator. 2016, February, I start working with DC GAN algorithms and then all entire GAN, I guess, world. But I think what was really amazing in the early days, I mean, 2017, 16, just the idea was injecting architectural intelligence into the spaces, and hopefully buildings can remember or dream or hallucinating. These concepts were not necessarily any more speculation, but if you think about truly the memory of the building, the function of the building as an AI model was a speculation, like again, 7 years ago. But I think once this installation happened, we learned that actually public art is so powerful when it merges with incredible collaboration with architectural imagination and respectfully the wisdom behind architectural design firms such as Zahid Architects and Patrick and his team. It was an amazing privilege to dive into DALL-E together. And by the way, we had this Slack channel with OpenAI team for more than 2 years. And what was amazing when they just kindly asked, like, do you want to like use this new tool that we thought that would be incredible? Of course, the first thing, Patrick, I think maybe our collaboration, by the way, it was before this, we were discussing the exhibition for Seoul at DDP, but it was incredible to dive into together this latent space. What was of course amazing, as Patrick showed, there was tremendous amount of outputs. Like it was probably the most fastest ever we were, by the way, again, this is 6 months before it's public. six, way before Midjourney and others. So what we allow, by the way, we were also fine tuning on like other diffuse models. We were fine tuning the entire and incredible architectural archive of the Zaha Hadid architects image archive and fine tuning other models. But what was amazing is once the selection is done, I think to me, the pioneering moment was, again, they were just a beautiful images, but what the architect team did is truly take these images and transform into 3D spaces. And that was truly inspiring to me. That is not anymore two-dimensional or just speculations, but a place hopefully we can feel, we can go. And I think, and on top of that, I think what was also innovative is, again, thanks to the architects and the entire team, there was this amazingly well-fit physical circular environment with a ceiling and the floor mirror with using really bright projectors. We took those images into a game engine and then projected back to the space. And I think that was another exploration of latent space, and not just by prompting, but I think on top of it, creativity just came. I do believe like all this process, like building the physical space, prompting the images, 3D modeling, sound exploration, and all together, again, 2 years, but it's pretty, was pretty fun to see. But these are images from very, very early sketches on, of course, Unreal Engine. But of course, over the days, they get just much more better lighting and better textures and so on, so on. But it was so exciting to go beyond comfort zone of image prompting and show like what this model, you know, fine tune on and where we can go in this latent space, what is a raw archive looks like. Because I think fine tuning the model was also a very inspiring early days. Now for any diffuse model, we can fine tune certain topics, but we also explored GAN models again because the architectural photography archive was incredible. I hope that was another like a very fun start point as well. So very grateful, very, very privileged to be in these very early days of diffuse models. And I just wanna finish with something completely different, but maybe just a remind for anyone working with AI. So by the way, 5th of May, if you're in Barcelona, we are giving a life back to the Gaudí's Casa Batlló. But I really love what happened with Patrick and collaboration. It really got kind of, we are not like losing the origin of the ideation. We are not losing the context of imagination. And I think as also Patrick mentioned, these tools are incredibly exciting for iteration, but explicitly requires questions. And I do believe the comfort zone just gets out of our zone when we start evolving ideas on top of prompt engineering. Engineering is important, but I don't believe it's just enough for creativity. But as the Zaha Hadid Architects team, 3D modeling worlds, that was very powerful. And right now, the other question is, of course, physical world we are living in this project, we were, it's a historic building, more than like a century. We just start thinking about like, can these diffuse models become a space between architecture, physical world, and virtual world. So this project was exploring the entire Gaudí data sets and the living architecture concept, give a life to a building in real time by the data that the building generates and reconstruct a kind of a living kind of a surface that was changing, over-changing based on the weather patterns and data. And then to make this project happen, we also create this replica of the building in somewhere else in New York, in here Rockefeller Center, but also the projection map to the original building to bring the public back again to discourse and discussion. And I think what I want to say is if architecture, media arts, eventually AI, data, and imagination of new materials, I think there's a very high chance that we can create a powerful new meaning as a mean of like collaboration. So I'm very grateful again, Patrick. And we were like, so totally, I believe, get excited around early tools. So happy to be the part of this beautiful day. Thank you, Neil, for inviting as always to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rafik. Let's move on to Ross. I mean, this is an amazing. I'm still processing all this information coming. Ross, it's great to see you.
Yeah.
Like to share your screen.
Yeah. Thanks, Neil.
you know, just so great and uplifting. I mean, my cells change shape when I look at some of the work that my contemporaries are doing, and nothing but respect. So for me to be engaged is something which is sort of beyond me. I mean, for years, I've been pushing the hell out of the idea of organic design, morphogenesis, biological transition. But of course, I work within the world of more like a human scale for the moment, and looking at analyzing what are those possibilities. And in 2013, I attempted a talk at TED Global. It was my second one in Oxford that was called Lovegrove Genesis. And I'm not sure if the audience got it, but it was the idea that what you would do is you would load up all the possible information on a subject, and it would then give you a result. Because I feel that the human mind in itself, well, it is advanced, but it's not advanced enough, not enough to solve a lot of these problems that we're talking about. So in those days, 2013, even the word algorithm was nascent, didn't hardly exist. So the way I would talk to people would be more about generative thought process. So not even AI, but that was the idea that you might be able to take a camera as an example. You would feed in every level of information you could, from a first daguerreotype through to the lens in a fish's eye, and just or the Hubble telescope. And what would that give you? That out of that would pop a solution that was beyond the restriction of the human mind. And then a lot of my designer friends were up in arms, people that you would know, and they say, oh, that's ridiculous. So I said, no, it's the idea that the designer would give that biodiversity by sprinkling pixie dust into that algorithm. And I love that concept. So here we are 10 years later, working with these new tools. The things that you see on screen here, they're mainly generated with Midjourney. I mean, sometimes with DALL-E by OpenAI, that's only for image enlargement. But I'm somebody that is never satiated by what I see or what I'm offered, meaning I cannot wait for the moment that we reach a biological level of interface. I refuse to type a key on a laptop to generate the forms that I'm looking at. I'm waiting so that I can have a seamless human interface with what is an extension of the human mind, with the AI. So what this is helping me do is it's taking me through to different scales of project, which often are speculative, and some things I really don't like. I mean, because I've gone from analog digital, 20th to 21st century, mechanical to biological. But en route, of course, as an industrial designer, one has to exercise another overarching level of logic, especially with issues today such as sustainability, resource use. Why do we do anything? These are big, big issues. But let's explode it up. Let's just let it all ride itself out, and then develop not even intelligence, but a form of wisdom that can actually step in and guide this. This second slide here just shows a couple of projects which fascinate me, in the sense that I've always been interested in the infinity of the human mind. And now AI is giving us that infinity of the human mind. And at my show at the Pompidou some years ago, that was called Convergence, where I was trying to converge science, biology, physics, astronomy, every aspect of creativity as I could see it, within the realm of the extension of the human mind. So it will give us this morphogenesis, which will change the nature of everything in alignment with additive technologies and so on, developing things and making them at cellular level. So just a couple of examples there. But you know, what happens with me is I have a team working on this. So we use all the tools that we've been talking about, and I'm off doing something else, and then somebody will bring me this, or show me this, and I'm blown away because I actually like being distanced from it. And then because everything is that is being generated is from my archive, of course I'm going to feel related to it. And this is the advantage. I think the advantage comes from practitioners who have an archival position, somebody who from day one have actually explored this territory. And ironically, even going back 20, 30 years, where one is trying to find the tools to communicate extreme levels of organic interface, as we see in nature. And now here we are, good or bad. And it's an aid memoir, but it's a prompt. And these two things you see here, the one there on the left, the sort of metallic black object, that's based on my Ridon man-machine study of what looked like a motorbike in carbon. And then the one on the right there was my proposal for the forthcoming expo in London. And this was just all based on my lensing technology, my lighting. So it shocks me, and it shocks me, but it takes me forward into feeling this empowerment that Patrick was talking about. But I see it more like superconductivity or quantum mechanics or quantum computing. I see it as a force of nature that it will blow everything apart. And what will come out of that will be a new emotional relationship with our 2D, 3D, 5D, 10D life that surrounds us. And that with that comes this amazing emotional charge and desire to participate. So that's me. And I've got a lot more to add, but that's enough, I think.
Fabulous, Ross. I can only echo some of the things you were saying. I've been blown away. I don't know anyone who hasn't been engaging with these tools who hasn't been blown away, but that was beautiful to see. Michel, would you like to share your screen?
Yes, thanks everybody. Thanks, Neil, for bringing us together. Great group of colleagues, friends. Rafiq, congrats on your exhibition in New York. I was recently there and I loved it. The way it brings people together at the pace of MoMA. So, but anyway, I wanted to share, let me put my screen, why can't I? Okay, let me put play. Here we go. So I wanted to start with maybe instead of the work that we have been doing in the office, understanding the dialogue between artificial intelligence, what I can learn from it before putting into our work, but with a group of people from our office. So we have a little group investigating text to image, text to text, text to music, text to video, and figuring out what is happening, what is going on. And for instance, these images, we just wanted to see how it would recognize a script, a prompt. So we prompted, what would happen if you have a bus that takes nature to spaces that don't have nature anymore? So thinking about a future scenario of ideas and how it would interpret a bus with a forest on top. And we were blown away, not by the example of the forest on top of a bus, but even by the design of the buses that were coming out, the imagery. And I kind of loved the first versions of DALL-E and the first versions of Midjourney, because the level of mistakes that were happening while you were prompting were amazing. It's getting more accurate, which is great. But the accuracy, I think, is also, I don't know, at least from our perspective in the office, when we're designing things, most of the mistakes that happen during the design process, we get a lot of feedback from those mistakes. And we bring them in, we talk about the design, what's going on with the building and so on. And so we were prompting again, what happens if a building is nature living together with people on buildings? And then some of the kids at the studio were putting prompts like, what if it looked a little bit like a Matrix or a certain qualitative movie inputs that could bring a certain idea of imagery to the architecture? But it would be interesting because by adding just in the style of something Blade Runner-esque or whatever, the architecture would change. So we were no longer even controlling the architecture at some point, but we were recognizing what, again, this important relationship of what we were feeding it, what was it feeding it back to us. For instance, here we were talking about architecture, but then it gave us these amazing motorcycles that, again, I was interested now in seeing if what happened if we started designing a motorcycle, or these incredible images, again, that were placed in this metropolis. But when the image started coming out, it focused on the motorcycle instead of the architecture that was supposed to come out of the prompt. So again, having a clarity and a relationship with the way we're communicating, the way AI is learning from us, but the way we are learning from AI, I think has been a crucial aspect of the work that we're doing now at the office. Again, more images, figuring out, again, what they could, where they can take us, where we could bring this back. Again, as Rafiq and Patrick, you were mentioning the idea of the 3D model, producing a 3D model after you have these digital sketches, because at the end of the day, for us right now in the studio, there are these digital sketches that become incredible, powerful imagery that are substituting, of course, stuff that we used to have from Pinterest, putting together some visual things for clients. Now we produce those images with the client, which is interesting. These are some images that we're working on right now with clients that, again, we're bringing them on the ride to understand the relationship of what we're looking for. And again, just as digital sketches where we come up with certain ideas and then we bring them back. And we've taken it a little step forward, because, for instance, and I have to come back to my musical roots, as you mentioned, Neil, I've been a huge fan of David Bowie. So we trained ChatGPT, well, we asked ChatGPT to learn from Midjourney to prompt in the best way it could, so we could start having conversations with ChatGPT to get the right prompts. So one quick example that I did is I asked ChatGPT if it could help me prompt based on Space Oddity lyrics by David Bowie and produce some images that would come out from music. So it was interesting to see that it divided the song into five parts. And you have one of the first images about ground control to Major Tom. And again, this is doesn't have to do anything with architecture. This is about communication and about the visuals and about how you feed something, or you start using cross-pollination to grab from one AI to another AI and start seeing the results that could happen. Image two about the liftoff. Image three, sitting in a tin can. And then, of course, the celestial perspective, no? Planet Earth is blue and there's nothing I could do. And then the final image. So again, I mean, I could show you some of the work that we're doing for in the metaverse for a distillery that we work for at the office. But I think that right now, in the moment that we're living and the conversation that we're going to have today, to me, it's more about, it has to do more about what are we learning? Where is this going? Where do we want to take it? And what's going to happen in the design process, no? Because again, we're mentioning, are they digital sketches? Are they projects that we're showing to the client? How much is the client involved behind the scenes? And so that's a little bit of what I wanted to introduce today. So it's not only about the design itself, it's about the use of tools and the way we can mix the tools to have better results or understand at least better where we're going. So thank you.
That was terrific, Michelle. You've outlined all the points we hopefully will discuss in the roundtable discussion afterwards. So let's move on to Wan Yu, who has been slightly differently working at the coalface of producing the software itself, but also producing designs and competing internationally. Wan Yu, welcome.
Thank you, Neil. Let me try to share my screen. Wait a second. Okay, can you guys see it?
Yes.
To be here today, as you said, maybe today is a historical moment. So I would like to share what we do as X-Cool, as a company. Which is always dedicated to empower the building industry by AI. So nowadays we know that AI already reshaped the design workflow, but how? As the previous way of working, I mean, the traditional way, we do the input, we do the concept design, designs, and we do export all the detailings and the drawings, and then we do the budget and the value engineering, and we do the decisions eventually. But there's a lot of circles in between, as we all know that we need a lot of time to go back and forth with the concept to the details and towards the budget, and also for the client to make decisions. There's a lot of back and forth. But with the AI today, we understand that the way we're doing can be reshaped. Especially the first step we are doing is searching for possibilities. We can use a AIGC, AI generated content for creative tools to help us to find ideas. And the middle part, we need to make sure the feasibility. So we need a design tool to make the procedure be precise and can really fulfill the demands. And finally, we need this kind of AI reviewing and management tools for us and our client to make their decisions and further to do the implementations. So this is the basic understanding of the workflow. And we are thinking today, we can start to from the first part on. This is what we do in 2007 to 2018 and using the GANs to mimic images. As we know, this is a very basic one in the beginning. And we found out the result is not controllable. And there's it's like a black box. It's just the AI generate images, but there's no control from the designers or users. So later on in 2018 and 2019, yeah, we start to, sorry, this didn't play, but somehow, we try to input the graphics and the graphics can generate images. And eventually we also go into from graphics, generate images and 3D models. But these are not enough from our creative tools. So afterwards, as we all know, there's a diffusion model came out. We also trained our model, and Patrick's here, and we tried this text to our chatbot. Sorry, it's in Chinese, but I translated it here. Then it can come out images like this. It's different from Midjourney because we are doing our own models with our fine tunings and our own ways of do the prompt engineering. And eventually we have this new tool. We did this not from last month on, we launched it. And you can see we combined with the Rhino workflow. So you can basically input any screenshot from your Rhino and you can get images out from it. It's more controllable. And you can see it's exactly you input as from your model and with all the details. And those details, we can ask the machine to switch from different styles to styles. And we can even ask them to mix up, for instance, a commercialized office style as the facade and maybe some non-linear type of a surface in the front, et cetera. So it's a very interesting way to help us to find possibilities. But as I said previously, we need to find the feasibilities. So this is the way XCool is doing as our main goal. We mix up the multi-models, the multi-modal and data sets into our xcool.ai. And it is a AI-driven design cloud. Maybe I can play any of this. For instance, here, you can just input any bubbles you like, and this AI will guessing if this drawing you want out from your sketch. And then the drawings inside can be fulfilled with the AI and with the 3D model. And this model is a precise model, which can be used for further constructions. So this is the way we are doing. We're not just stopped in the images for finding the possibilities with its creations, but we also with the design tools. Because we only have 5 minutes, I will speed up. And the final part is the reliability. We can create this AI reviewing tool by the classification of our AI models. And now our AI model can understand the 2D content, can rebuild all those things in 3D. And also to fulfill the semantics which are missing in CAD drawings, for instance, and generate our new type of model with our AI-driven beam and cloud, our own format and standard to get this new model out from this non-symmetric CAD drawings. And further, we can also reviewing all those designs by the simulations and analyzing. And the final part, we have this AI design, AI reviewing tool. Sorry if the Chinese and English, but anyhow, so you upload your drawing and the AI will try to understand the drawing, not just building this model out from the 2D drawings, but we can understand the content. For instance, where is the doors and where is the windows and where is the lifts? And when the machine understands the content of the drawings, and it will like very useful for the machine to do the further job. For instance, we can do the inspection. We can check and locate where are the problems. And in this way, we create this product with the regulation checking. So on the right side is the regulations the AI checked on the drawings. You can find out where is the problematic area and you can further mark it or ask the AI to help to to re-justify it. So this is the way we think the future work gonna be. And the next way, maybe the next step for us is to find out after the possibility searching, feasibility making, and the reliability checking, maybe we can start to see how AI can work with the realization. Okay, this is my part. Thank you.
Thanks, Fanny. That was that final section on the review tool. I thought was really astonishing. We can maybe come back to that in a moment, but that was really, really super interesting. And I guess while we're all sort of working on the tools that are available, Wanyu is producing the tools. So it gives a very, very interesting new perspective of, to the whole thing. Finally, I'd like to invite Daniel Bolajan to show us the work of Coop Himmelblau. Daniel himself has been at the kind of coalface also developing the tools in the office. So it's appropriate to follow on from Wanyu. Daniel, welcome.
Hi, Niels. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's great to be here. So I'm going to try to speed through this. I know we have 5 minutes. I'm going to mostly focus just on some of the latest results or progress that we did with this project. So Deep Himmelblau project explores this idea or the possibility in connection with humans to teach machines to be creative, to interpret, perceive, propose new designs, and augment design processes. The team right now is composed of Wolf Biggs, Carlene, myself, and Filena. And mostly we are looking at three main parts, like gestalt ideas, organizational ideas, like functional organization and technical when it comes to more pragmatic optimization aspects. For those of you that don't know Coop Himmelblau, it's kind of very, very intricate in a way style that it's quite hard sometimes to represent semantically. We are lucky with the fact that we have a large data set, close to 1,000 projects that we can generate our data sets from, like multimodal data sets. So our understanding is design is a multimodal endeavor. So we're always looking at a multimodality, like I'm developing Deep Himmelblau as a multi-node in a way network where we allow in a way our designers to establish their own workflows and how they decide to connect different nodes in a way in this system. So here you just see a few types of nodes that we are currently developing. But an issue with these networks is, of course, this idea of they are very strict in a way. They are specific to either domain transfer, presentation learning. And we all know that design and spatial architectural process is not relying on one modality alone. So then it's always this kind of question of how actually we create certain systems that allow our designers to kind of define their own workflows, their own modality, how they decide to engage with these systems. And then this idea for us, the idea of interaction, how designers interact with these tools and how these tools interact with each other is something super important. And this builds, of course, on top of this idea of idea of a thousand brain theory, a new theory of intelligence from Jeff Hawkins, where it's this kind of understanding of intelligence being more than just the brain. We are also looking or understanding the importance of developing processes and workflows, how we interact with these kind of tools. And of course, we are also looking at this aspect of, we are not just trying to have these networks for us generate just pretty images, but also we are trying to look at these networks as potential tools that can provide new solutions to certain ideas that they are learning. So for us, it's really important, like this idea of how can we have this kind of network that learns from the entire body of work developed by Kupino and Blau, but at the same time, how can we grow? So as designers, how can we grow together with this network? So recently we started to look at something that became very popular since Midjourney and also ChatGPT when it comes to the way that the model is trained according to user feedback. So we started to look at the possibility of integrating this kind of user feedback into the process. And those of you that already know the Deepin Law project, we were developing this idea of federated learning, where we are trying to train multiple networks locally on our designers' computers and then personalizing in a way the data sets in that, not data sets, sorry, the networks in that kind of way. Yeah. So I'm just going to skip through. We all know that one of the challenges with Midjourney, DALL-E, all kind of image generator networks is this idea of they are trained on specific data sets. And very often, in a way, they are very biased towards, or they are fine-tuned towards a specific type of style, let's say. So we started to look then, is it possible also for us to start to fine-tune the models in a way that describes better the semantics of our office, and how can we generate our own model in a way for that? So here, I also have to show very briefly the diffusion node. Out of, we have roughly almost like 50 nodes in the Deepin Blau network. So I'm just showing you right now the diffusion mode and node, and I'm going to show you just a few options of this. Just for the comparison, like if we use the prompt as an interior circulation of a building made out of concrete, trying to describe in a way sort of composition from Deepin Blau, if you use that prompt in Midjourney, that's the kind of preferent preference that Midjourney has, the aesthetics and the style, and then DALL-E 2, you get those kind of results and Fable diffusion, yeah? So once we start to train our own model with our own specific language and data sets, we start to fine tune and push in a way the model in a direction that starts to describe more in a way our semantics. And you see in the lower part of this slide, you see some of those results. And of course, we were able to generate then thousands and thousands and thousands of results quite easily. And we had like an entire effort in our office, like people describing, you know, images. So for us, it was very important to have a language that is really specific to our office and to describe some ideas the way, or to use the semantics that we use mostly in the office, yeah. And the idea again here is not necessarily just to have networks that almost like automate, but how can we learn and grow together in a way with this network? So that's why for us it was important to have the entire office feedback, yeah, like in terms of how would you describe some features and so on. So here is very fast just how that node works. So you just see here, like we input the prompt and then you start to have all these kind of results generating that you can very fast iterate through. So this is a speed up version just for the sake of time. So we started to develop quite a few methods and right now, like ways how we can explore in a way that kind of latent space of the network of the node that we fine tuned. And then we also look at this kind of idea, how can we retain a compositional consistency with a sort of prior conditioning, like specifying the type of perspective, and can we retain that perspective while creating variations? So we develop different kind of ideas. So the same also like happens, like if you, most of the time when you use language models and Midjourney and DALL-E and so on, you have a perspective, but then it's very hard to create a different perspective of the same building, you know. Yeah? So I started to work on this kind of technique of trying to have a similar composition or consistency. So here, for example, we are still in a way developing this feature, but as you can see, we can prompt it in a way to give you like a top view, a front view, or a side view. Yeah, and in some cases, some work, others not. For example, in this example, left side view is not really working that well, central is not working, that's why I'm not showing it. But it has in a way this capacity in a way to retain compositional consistency and be able to almost like create like around an idea, different perspectives. So we have different techniques then also to constrain or retain that kind of composition based on certain inputs. And also the same like when it comes to more pragmatic applications. So I'm just going to skip to this. So these are different techniques and that we are using to explore the internal idea of design. And for us, it's very interesting because this is really opening the doors for a lot of interesting topics to be addressed. It's not necessarily that yes, designers are obsolete, but I think it's a way of us understanding even better the kind of semantics that we are working with, the style, the aesthetics, and then further developing away our own, in a way, design abilities. So this concludes my presentation. I'm really looking forward for the discussion. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Daniel. I was struck by that, the question you asked, how can we learn and grow together, which you're of course applying to AI plus humans. So, you know, AI as a prosthesis, as an extension, as an augmentation of the human mind that kind of Ross was referring to in some way. But I think also in some senses, this forum itself, we're all learning together, not just here, but also I think more broadly, I can see a kind of form of swarm intelligence where each person is learning collectively about this new world, and a world that I think is changing on a day-to-day basis, which makes it even more challenging because the goalposts keep moving. I think we've had a lot of incredible questions. I think that Michelle laid out a whole bunch of questions as well about, you know, where are we going? What are we learning? And what does the future hold? Well, we haven't got any answers, but we've got a lot of interesting kind of questions. So maybe we should just kind of kick off with that general sort of question. Where are we going and where is this going to take us? I don't know if Patrick, you'd like to sort of kind of make some comment about what you think it's going to do in terms of the way in which an office operates. I mean, in Zaha Hadid Architects is, of course, is a large office, and it's kind of, it's really having an impact on one of the major players in the world of architecture.
Well, I mean, I'm very much encouraged by what Daniel has been showing, because the first round of showing the deep Himmelblau, I wasn't convinced. Then DALL-E 2 came around, and I thought probably this wipes out his project, that even for the Himmelblau itself, they would use this and prefer over their own tools. But what I've seen now, I'm quite amazed. And I really have to ask, these images, which have superb quality and coherency, generate out of their own network, train up, that I find quite stunning. And I wonder how that leap was possible. But also I love it the way he has these new features, you know, retaining perspective, bringing it up and asking for this for quite a while, a top view, a front view, a side view, and there's a sense of coherency, constraining the composition in the iteration. I mean, these are features which I think they would, I mean, the one way to go with this, I mean, is, yeah, I would love to implement this for us as well. I mean, we have a small team, and we wanted to build our own archive and trainable new network, and I was a bit worried that this might not work out, that it's going to remain crude, but this is incredibly encouraging, because on the one hand you have these mega models which deliver everything, but everything have a kind of consistency across, and now I see this inverted comma self-made model. Wow. So that means we have to invest in this, and I think that's very powerful. And I think also what these features Daniel is showing, of course, they would also make a lot of sense for DALL-E and Midjourney to integrate, but the specificity of tailoring for us, because these firms are these kind of tools, they're not looking as specifically as designers, they're looking, you know, at every image production and now future videos. So that's the future. So actually Daniel is kind of spot on, working on the kinds of things. Of course the 3D is the next element, and I saw some flickering in the background, but yeah, that's the future in terms of owning these tools and developing them and having a discipline specific. And then we can still go out for ideation, have these kind of crazy melanges and hybridizations and so on. That's something which we don't expect from Daniel's tool, but then you can bring that into maybe as a constraint of a composition into that more specific tool. And so that's very encouraging. Also was very encouraged by X-School and the way this is kind of integrating it through all stages of the workflow. Including already working on Rhino integrated plugins for the AI generator. So these are all very, very potent directions. So it makes sense. I mean, I feel more like an end user, but I think in terms of Daniel and X-School, they're more kind of the developers, which is very important to have in our field. So I'm really positively encouraged that we are, as we're investing in this as well, that it will bear fruit.
I think for me it's very, can I just add here something? For me it's very interesting because I think when these tools came out, a lot of creatives almost like they gave up, almost it was like it's over for us, yeah. And I see it so wrong in a way, that kind of view is so such a wrong view, because yes, you have these kind of big models like OpenAI models that are like ChatGPT and so on, yeah. But the amazing thing about those tools is that they are giving you a sort of foundation, yeah. And you can use, in a way, those tools and start to fine-tune your own tools now and start to developing your
own target. It was dependent on this being somehow, you could feed off that to make your own next tool. Okay, that's what I thought. I mean,
yes. Yes, because there are a lot of concepts in a way that just with your own data sets, you cannot train the network with all the concepts that you have to train it with. And then you can rely on this kind of large models like Stable Diffusion, for example. That's one model that it's out there.
Because it's all can find you can integrate that. You're building on top of that.
So you can integrate yours. And there is also Lion data sets, for example, that are open source. That you can use in a way
to find your own and so on and so forth. Yeah, yeah,
exactly. So it's not an end of the creative person. It's actually
you're competing very well. I mean, and that's quick. That's really quick.
Yeah.
One thing you mentioned, Patrick, is this term discipline specific. Now I want to maybe bring in Michel here, because Michel is, if anyone, is kind of somebody who doesn't really pay any regard to discipline. Start off as a musician, and they had to kind of focus on architecture, but it seems like the world is opening up towards motorcycles and footballs and God knows what else. I want to ask Michel whether you see that the nature of architectural design itself and the relationship design is really changing in this way that we can open up in some way into different territories
I'm totally, and again what you were saying, Patrick, that Daniel, amazing. I wasn't expecting also to see you guys implementing it on your own. I think that the beautiful way that you're doing it as a platform that could also still have plugins of different, either other companies, maybe Runway in the future for videos, that instead of having you doing all the videos, you have another company maybe plugging into what you're doing already. I think that's great. What I was trying to present at the beginning in my presentation was a little bit of I need to understand first what's happening there before getting our clients involved. I want to, even the people from my office, I want to have a way of understanding where this is going, having the conversation within the office to create a dialogue, then to be able to really understand, do we bring in the clients, in what stage? Do we show them this behind the screen, in the backstage, or do we wait until we present the full project? So again, to me, it's the ethics behind everything that's happening right now, because we'll get into that a little bit later, but we're growing so fast technologically that we haven't advanced as humans as much as we need to in our consciousness to understand everything that will evolve in AI. Everything that we have right now is super advanced, and we haven't done our work as humans to be more empathic, to understand the human values and how to translate those human values then to any machine learning, AI models, whatever. And again, I don't want to generalize design in general. I love being an architect, but I love more being a human being in this world of design. So to me, it takes a little bit one step back to see this is beautiful, because what you presented, Daniel, and also X-School, I think this raises a lot of people were doubting, are they going to lose their jobs? What are designers going to do? So this sets the stage saying, no, I mean, jobs will change. We'll have different jobs. We'll have different ways of calling them. We'll have different careers. I mean, I'm right now in Madrid with my daughter because she's studying design in Madrid. And I'm telling her, I don't know if your school will exist in 6 months. and I this might be far-fetched, but she's studying design here. And I'm like, I don't know what they're teaching you here, because this changes every day, that at least these conversations should happen, because pedagogy needs to change. Our education needs to change, and our focus on how we're approaching things. So, thanks again, X-School and Daniel, for opening this up to many of the infinite possibilities. And this takes me back to when, you outsource renders, and then you say, no, I want to have a render team inside my office, which has the style of what my office wants to show. And I want to have everything detailed or custom made for the way my office presents. So this is kind of the same thing that happened at some point where nobody was doing these high quality renders or image or movies, no? But I'll leave it there.
I think, Vishal, you're absolutely right. Education seems to be the kind of crucial issue here now. Right now, we're educating the students who are going to be going out into a world in which almost we don't even know what that world is. I always say to my students, what we need to design right now is not a building, but the future of our own discipline, and try and understand where it's going. Maybe I want to let it go free flow, but I want to just bring in the two out, kind of outsiders, as it were, to the world of architecture, especially firstly Ross, who's kind of, I think, a very close, he's been watching, monitoring, especially the work of Patrick over the years, and how he sees it from the kind of world of industrial design, and maybe how that is slightly different to the world of architecture itself.
Well, you can see from my body language that I'm just listening and processing, and the fact that I'm here is not because I'm a designer. It's not because of that. The influence on me has not been design. It has been architecture, because the educational process within architecture is fundamentally far-reaching. It's a higher level of education that does not exist in design education at all. There's not one school in the world that practices anything that I'm thinking. Equally, it depends what you're fed on. I mean, I'm listening to a number of the presentations that are talking about systems analysis and evaluation and the sort of data-driven generation of ultimately building something. I was then thinking, I wonder if Apple would have ever employed that. Not in a million years, because the device that they have, or their main device, is not governed by any of that. It's governed by its content and its ultimate ambition to be as thin as possible of that scale, whatever. So none of the three-dimensional excitement that we see has any bearing whatsoever on one of the most important things that's ever been designed on Earth, 2 billion units. So I'm thinking about the relativity to the industrial process, because ultimately, and I don't want to sound boring, because I'm not, but this thing that, you know, I'm looking for the logic and the beauty. And that's why I'd like to use AI for the logic, because I don't think human logic is good enough, especially in an age when we've got serious things coming down the road. I mean, whatever you're talking about, agriculture, anything, you know, food generation generally, whatever that might be. But on top of that, one thing that's really interested me over the years, and that's why most of the people I speak to are people like you They are not designers, because I am incapable of doing a wooden stool. I'm just absolutely not interested. Gone. And the guillotine's come down. But what I am interested in is those zones where the things that you guys are saying, including Rafiq and so on, everything that I'm feeling today emotionally can be put into an experience of life, which means I see the architecture that certainly people like, you know, Patrick's outfit and Mad and so on are pushing hard on, even Wolf, who I know, is what are the transportation systems that meld with that and flow, and drones that interact from above and come in and out? What is that impact? And I'll never forget, there was that famous photograph of this car outside Villa Savoy in whatever date it was. And Villa Savoy looked really modern and white. And then there was this stupid wooden box of a car outside. And it's this thing where who's keeping pace with what? So I think in my field, and talking to Michael there as well, the idea of transportation systems, car design, that those areas which need to be fundamentally dematerialized and logical because of the resources they use, and to have something which is part of a morphogenesis of logical evolution. You know, nature evolves with great purpose and adapts via atmospheric condition. And none of it is ugly. Nobody can ever has the right to say that some of these fish they're discovering down in the depths are ugly. They're just fascinating. So I think there needs to be a fundamental academic release of the things that I've seen over the years in some of these schools, ETH, Bart, AA, so on, which are behind closed doors, and they've never really been fully released. And it's no surprise to me that the voice behind all of this is an architectonic generated voice, first and foremost, because then it'll feed back into design, not design feeding back into you guys. I think it's the other way around. So this is I'm here to represent all those, well, they're not many, but a few of us who are taking higher risks in terms of trying to explode the form pool of what surrounds us, instead of this completely predictable aesthetic of yesterday, which is absolutely yesterday. I mean, it's you either jump or you get off, you know. Yeah.
Maybe Rafiq, I could bring you into. I often think that maybe in a previous incarnation you might have been an architect somehow, because you're not an architect, but somehow architecture, buildings are both your data, your material, and also your canvas. And I get the sense anyway that architecture is right there, and your relationship, especially with Gehry's work, especially, and now more recently with the Zaha office.
First of all, like, architecture is one of the most inspiring disciplines for, I think, many artists and designers. The quality of imagination and building things in physical world, I mean, massive respect. But I think this is a very inspiring time. For example, even I'm not an architect, and respecting the field and imagination behind it, these tools are just allowing us to like create worlds, but not necessarily make them ready for inhabiting or creating a function. But I think what is incredible to me is liberating this process of like imagination. And then I totally agree that I don't believe we have this fear of like losing jobs at all. I think it's more about like creating more jobs about new worlds that we don't even know how to create. I think when we see the potentials of these systems and their potentials, they are much bigger than our fears. I think our fears are just our reflexes not to fall down and just not to hit our heads. I mean, they are just so simple. First, I think low-hanging fruits of losing things. Actually, we are, I think, gaining more creativity and more, hopefully, opportunities of imagination. So I'm very optimistic about that part. But I think I totally agree that I think Patrick mentioned, and also like Daniel clearly represented, I think custom models are totally very important. I don't believe this collective memory representation of just giant multi-billion parameters are just a product and service. I don't believe they are creative tools. They are just amazing to start with, but not necessarily pioneering ideas or finding new worlds. So for example, fine-tuning a model, of course, another like resource, not necessarily easy, and also, you know, take some know-how and practice. But it may bring much more unique worlds that are more domain-specific, archive-specific. So I do believe our next role will be curating the worlds instead of like creating them first. So for example, let's say we have multi, whatever the open source data set that makes sense to use is not just enough. So for example, an example, I was in Iceland and instead of, you know, in a comfort zone, think about glaciers, I spent more than 10 days with 8 kilometers walking with 50 kilograms of gears and lots of drones and photography camera to record data. The reason is, I think we will most likely going to an era where people will be appreciating their own data sets and their creations through with customized worlds. Because the worlds will create many things we may imagine, but not the specific curation of a certain expectation from these models. And I think also one thing I'm super inspired still, like the moment in our Slack channel with Zahid Architects team, like there was this moment of inputs came and to the next day morning, we had these 3D models. It was incredible. I mean, I think people working in special design and understanding context of space will most likely see very different potentials than artists like me, most interfaced aesthetics and other values. And lastly, I think this part is very inspiring. I hope you also enjoy this. So at the moment we are just in text to image, text to video, not even text to sound yet. But I do believe the process is much more powerful if it's text to image, to sound, to video, to send and life. So I think, I hope architecture is representing these, architecting the realities. And that's really, I'm so closely watching everyone here and pioneering these worlds, super inspiring.
I think I'd echo that. I echo Ross's comment. I'm just absorbing things today. It's just incredible to find out what is happening. This is why I think it's so historic, just to bring together all of you kind of working in different ways at the same kind of topic. But I want to bring, before opening up completely, I want to sort of bring Wan Yu in, because we, you know, many ways everyone else is kind of using the tools, you're developing the tools and using the tools to some extent. And we, I think it was a really informative to see what is coming in the pipeline in terms of what you're producing. What do you see today that kind of maybe makes you, prompts you to rethink maybe the tools that you're developing?
Thank you, Neil. Actually, today we are really thinking this big models, big language models, big image models came out, and what is our advantages are as architects has the industry know-how to reform our own way of workflow by ourselves. So we cannot wait for other like Google or OpenAI to help us, but we need to use our own data set, know-how, algorithm models, everything to find our own way. So the workflow I showed previously is the latest thing we figured out. It's not just for creative, we find the possibilities. But the more important thing is to help us to free from all those repetitive work, let's say, because in between all those design and decision making, there's always a lot of back and forth. And when I was an architect, we are really tired of this, because sometimes those requests are not really reasonable, let's say, and finally the client will go back to the first option, and this is ridiculous. But with the help of AI, we can find out what is the best option out from all those, and this will help us back to the truth of the design, which is help us to do the operational research to find out the best options based on different parameters or different importance of factors, let's say. So I think AI here is helping us to find the possibilities and also to help us to analyze the feasibilities and eventually to help us to make sure the reliabilities. So I think this is the way how we should work with the AI. And eventually this AI will make a new type of data standard and even the format. And this format can further link to the factories to do the prefabs. And eventually the entire industry is going to be changed. Yeah.
So when you could just put it, follow up one thing before we completely open it up. That is, could you maybe explain a little bit about what the review tool was? Am I right in assuming that that was able to analyze a design as such? Because you mentioned at one point you've been asked to use AI to review competition entries, which is, I thought, was pretty interesting. And was the model you showed, the 2.0 one you just released, when you do those buildings, has it everything integrated into it? Is it all a model in which you're understanding the way that plumbing works and so on, mechanical engineering, or is it, how deep does it go?
Yeah, first of all, the AI reviewing is based on different AI models. The first step is to do the classification, to ask the AI to understand the drawings, the images. So with the big data set of the training, we can reach to the point of 99.8% of the accuracy. So the machine can understand the drawings. Where is the doors? What's the distance from door to the fire door, the entry door to a fire door, for instance? And this could help us to build the new model that the AI can understand drawings right now. Because our current language we're using in architectural field is so-called the level 3, which is the machine readable files. But this machine readable file has contain the contents which the machine understands. So BIM might be the machine under machine readable contents, for which is the L4. According to the ISO standard for this data. And we are really trying to find out the level 5 way to dealing with the basic data, which is the machine understandable content. This is the most important thing. Currently, our machine doesn't understand the content for architectural industry. For the large language model, there's a lot of data from the human context, from all those internet. So a machine can understand the text, the language, but now they don't understand drawings. And we are here to help the machine to understand the drawings, because China has a lot of drawings. So we have a large amount of data set to train the model. And further with the understanding of the model with the drawings, and we can do a lot of things. For instance, analyzing. As Leo mentioned, we are kind of AI judge for a competition entry. So the AI can review the standard of the design. And also we can do the inspections for the to help the enterprise, for instance, the developers to review the drawings, if they fit for their enterprise standards requirements or not, or even further to help the government to reviewing all the drawings to get the authorization. So this is, I think, the next step. Our entire industry should also work together to help this our language to be understandable. Yeah.
So I might just assume that in the future, whatever is generated already conforms to all these kind of requirements. It'll be embedded into the software tool itself.
Yes. We have our own format we call the AI-driven building information model on cloud, which contains three different dimensions. 3D model is just the one part of it, which is one dimension. The second dimension, we call it data. And this data is not just the information of the building itself, but also the big data, for instance, the surrounding information, the POIs we get from the map suppliers, and also the data from the human feedbacks for our further reinforcement learning training. This is the second dimension. And the third dimension, which we call the R. R stands for the rules, regulations, and laws. Regulations are the most, regulations and the codes are the most clear part for us, and we can translate it to the machine language. And second part is the rules, and which the rules can be told, but can be not understood by the machine. We need to teach the machine to understand it. And eventually it's the law, which means how we understand the beauty, which is a very blur for the machine, which need a large amount of data to train it. So with the three dimensions, we can create this new type of language, which when the AI generates results, it contains the three informations, which is the very important for our industry, because now drawings cannot be understood, and also drawings cannot be understood by people. You know, some people on the site, I was working in OMA for some sites, and when I walk to the site, the workers don't understand the site, and they need someone who understands drawing to talk to them and how to build the wall and how long the wall is. They don't look at the drawing. And also for the people do the value engineering, do the budgets, they don't look at the drawings, they look at the numbers. So this is something we are missing already in our current language. Yeah, so I think in the future, when AI generates new results, it should contain those three dimensions. Yeah, not just graphics, let's say.
Right, it sounds like AR is gonna play a huge role in this future, where you can compare not drawings, but a kind of simulation to the thing itself.
Yeah.
Let's open this up to discussion. I mean, I'm absolutely like everyone else. I'm just blown away, not just by AI, but also this kind of the new developments that are happening in your individual practices, which are really, I'm just absorbing all this. I'm not even sure I can process it because it's so new and so fascinating and looking at different sort of angles. But for sure, it's an incredibly informative kind of session. I'm not sure we're getting any answers yet, but we're certainly getting lots of questions. So let's just open it up to whoever wants to kind of chip in.
Yeah, I just want to come in on this aspect. So we've been talking a lot about the generative and the ideation and generating concepts, images, with, you know, associating, which I think is one important step. And in Vanyu's talking a lot about the analytical requirements. So for that, you would have a 3D a model, most probably, or a 2D drawing, and then to automate, but then also automation means augmentation, when you can compare hundreds and thousands of options, and you loop a generative, let's say, system with an analytic selection system, heuristic selection system. And we've done that only so far. We're doing this with interiors, furnishings for corporate landscapes, Bürolandschaft concepts. And in our case, it's based on a large array of modules you can use. And then using Unity ML agents, machine learning agents, to train systems to use those modules is a large number, and the combinatorics explodes also to infinity. And then have certain criteria, objectives, the machine learning generation learns how to optimize or have good solutions and multiple, for instance, optimizing a number of seats, then optimizing, and then have several objectives that learn, can simultaneously kind of integrate with permeability, also diversity of types of furniture and settings. And so that's one thing that is quite potent, and for large complex projects, you that's the only way to home in on a certain degree of rationality. And this is with objective measures. But the next level, what we have been working on, is also to substitute some of the, let's say, difficult to measure, but possibly to simulate, for instance, agent simulation, where we're talking about encounter frequencies and conversions of encounters into communication instead of with hundreds and thousands of agents. Plus now the idea of, for instance, using neural networks to simulate how we would appraise, that's not a direct measure, how would we appraise eligibility or orientation? Can a human being step into a complex multi-level atrium and identify the escalators, or identify a route, or identify exits and entries and the offerings? So for that, this is another frontier of working. And of course, these need to be then looped into some kind of generative and ideas. And these visual comprehension testing, you can actually already do with images. For that, you don't necessarily need to go into 3D. So you could have loops of selection a bit like automating what we now do when we look at hundreds of these images. Intuitively, we could have a kind of image processing algorithm, ML, a machine learned kind of system, which follows certain heuristics we believe to be similar to a human comprehension. So, but ultimately, a lot of these will depend on the 3D. So I'm quite excited about that. And I think all of that, for me, since the last 2-3 years, we've been kind of working heavily on the metaverse. I believe that's coming massively. And the amount of design that is requiring from us, when you suddenly, within the next 3-5 years, every institution, every organization, a school or whatever, what have you, in Ferment, would have a website at the moment, and not even a venue, or has a venue and a website, will have to have virtual spaces. So, and then they will have a quicker turnaround, and they will be dynamically adjusting. So that huge amount of work coming towards us, that will be really driving the, I think, the adoption of a lot of these smart tools, because for a relatively small firm, it doesn't count. I mean, if you have to train up and build a whole team to train up a model, let's say you're specific, only very large firms can kind of do that. And if they have, if they churn out 50 projects or 100 projects per year, most firms won't do that. But I think in terms of metaverse, this will be kind of a tenfold, and smaller firms will do more and so on. That's where I feel this comes in at the right moment. And it will be kind of a very powerful synthesis of metaverse design requirements and AI empowerment. And but they're also, to that extent, I mean, there was also 3D spaces, they're not images. They have this image recognition and atmospheric distribution, all the semiology and phenomenology topics, but they also have real questions of permeability, of visibility, connectiveness, and so on, which the real world environments have. So I think that's what I'm thinking about a lot, and I think this will drive the and once the economics of this is starting to kick off, this will drive a lot of this research, I think, and then will also be available for architecture in general.
Yeah, I think, Patrick, I think that's interesting. And when we were working, for instance, on the distillery that we did for this tequila company in Mexico, for Decentraland in the metaverse, the whole conversations were also about, why are we designing architecture that looks like architecture that could be built in Earth? Why are we speaking a language that we speak on Earth? Because we could have a totally different language. Why do we look like avatars that look like humans? I mean, even though we change our colors or jackets or faces or whatever. But again, shouldn't we be talking about, I mean, again, at least in my mind, we want to do something in other worlds to feed this world. We want to learn from different scenarios to bring this back to Earth, to our human aspect, and to really engage in ways that we're learning from the different things that we're doing. Because I mean, all the work that we all have, it's very emotional, it's deep, it moves you in many ways. So I'm always worried about the disconnect of so technology so advanced that it starts losing those aspects. It starts losing our questioning, our humanity, our ethics, no? So again, I think it's a beautiful opportunity to test stuff out. But as I would always say, if you have a client that's, and forgive my cursing and my words, he's an asshole on Earth, he will be an asshole in the metaverse, and he will be. So how do we start kind of working with the idea that we should also start implementing and guiding in a more deeper sense the process of learning from metaverse or learning from AI, bringing it back to planet Earth and to our human aspect and coming out of this pandemic, no?
You know, Michael, in my discussions with Patrick, you know, talking about the metaverse, one of the things that I've always felt was missing is it's missing intimacy. You know, it's too big, it's too far away from you. But everything that I'm hearing here is so fundamentally important because this idea of dematerialization. So we need to make less. We do, because we're just filling the world with stuff. Okay, so how do we do that, but still maintain a life experience, an experiential existence, you know? And remember, we must not underestimate the power of our senses. And I'm just talking about that, really. You know, the idea that you can input so much into just this one part of your body. And I think a lot of people live in a way which is not the way they want to live. They can't afford it, maybe. So maybe this creative expression, a little bit what Refik has been talking about too, this kind of explosion of creativity that allows anybody to some degree, maybe with a bit of assistance in the way they use an app, to have these broader experiences. I mean, when I saw Refik's installation in Melbourne, I mean, I went on my knees. I mean, I just felt like it was a religious experience. And then you walk out the door and the life seems so boring. I mean, if it's like that now, what's it going to be like? So rather than just let it run, you participate in it and you guide it, because it will absolutely replace at least 50% of the mass of stuff that this world feels dependent on. And that is what I'm talking about, that level of dematerialization. You know, on bad days when I'm feeling guilty about the way the world is going, the best thing I could do is stop working. Because, you know, if I'm successful, I get a thing called success from failure, which means I'll take a project to a certain level, and for whatever level reason, it won't happen. Maybe cost, economics, things change. But as long as you stay true to your value system, you've lost nothing. You've survived, you've lived, you've shown, you've done. So I think that idea, the three-dimensional expression of humanity, going back to stone tools at a time when, you know, our ancestors had to make everything, and their experience was nature. We are new nature, and we are the avatar and agent of, we are embedded in nature. So it, by definition, everything that we create is a natural extension. So let's enjoy that, not give it some greenwashing, but just enjoy that idea that the expression doesn't really have to exist. And that it just needs to touch people. And everything that Patrick's saying is so true. It's going to happen within 5 years, of course.
That's why we call our collaboration Architecting the Metaverse. We're still gonna with Refik.
I think Ross, thank you from my heart for your words, but I think, I mean, one of the reasons I was seeing a lot of positivity when this type of tools arrives is, like, I don't know if you ever check recently Twitter, like the speed of feed changes, like surreal. And we just had a 1 hour fun, and just look at the Twitter API about generative AI. Just for fun, please have a look. The reaction of tools, prompting, and people like diving in latent space and exploring and giving these hints to each other. I never saw any like co-creation in any social media moment before. Like NFTs and blockchain was exciting, but for sharing a work and try to get value back. But now people are sharing prompts and techniques and tricks and whatever. I mean, this co-creating, no? Like, I mean, if we imagine like the history of humanity, I mean, are we ever this aware of a moment we ever alive and be able to share like this level of fast? I mean, what is the acceleration speed of this for humanity? I mean, the exponential, beyond exponential, like just one spike. I don't think there's any like some other. So
it's amazing. Yeah, I mean, I was a huge crypto fan, and I mean, I love the creativity and the explosion and the acceleration. And this one is kind of three times that. Mm-hmm. And also, yes. You know, this kind of GDP4, kind of the integration of all these kind of new tools, new entrepreneurship, new companies, new. I mean, I also heard just, you know, there's somebody stretching, stripping kind of GDP4 into Blender, and now you speak, and it's really models are generated. I haven't looked at that yet, but I think this, because it's also this fantastic integration with programming languages and programming. So there I foresee a lot. What you're talking about, Rafiq, and. I wonder if anybody thinks would have tried that, how you can speak to your 3D software and generate 3D geometry.
I've been waiting. That's what I've been waiting for.
wait,
Wait a week, Ross. In a week or two, maybe, maximum. Everything is advancing. And no, and I'll just share this for fun, guys. This is just putting it out there. But I recently wrote a piece not so long ago about there is no coincidence that we're living in this world of technology like never before right now. In the same moment that people are legalizing psychedelics for advanced psychological treatment to advance humans faster than they could ever before, because psychologists are also very scared now that they're not advancing as much as they could with their patients. So everything is trying to catch up to this quick rise of technology, because if our empathy and our, and again, I don't want to be the one coming always back to the human aspect, if we're not equal to everything that's happening in this quick manner in technology, we're gonna not understand a lot of the things that we could have embedded in. And I think that's I mean, just I'll leave it there. I'm not trying to convince anybody to go to therapy, but there is no coincidence whatsoever.
You know, I've always thought that the human brain, this is a very odd thing to say, but I've said it in various lectures, is that it's working so far below its capacity. And I've always wondered why the brain was developed with its 1.4 liters or whatever it is. Why was it created at that scale to only use maybe 12%? And so I've always had this belief that the human brain, mind, with its consciousness, has the ability to absorb and correlate to everything. I mean, literally to everything. You know, and maybe the universe doesn't even exist. Maybe it's a human invention. It's just something that qualifies our existence. I don't know, but there are bigger things than this. But talking about today, but you know, it takes us closer maybe to this understanding of vastness of information, data, because I love data, and I think data, what Refik again was saying about, you know, you compose all of the data that's, you know, your biological physiognomic data, and that defines you, and then you put that into the product, that means that's for you, which means that you will never get rid of that because it's absolutely a prosthesis of you. So these are things which have a lot of logic in terms of how eventually, what our relationships are with the things that we buy, own, acquire, rent, experience, whatever that is. So this is a fundamental sort of form of economics we're talking about, coming out of these platforms that are in discussion now. And they need to be sort of mapped out. And then when the time is right, go and take a look at them, because the big biological complexity of that will coalesce into things which have, you know, meaning. I mean, however we define that meaning, that goal.
Maybe, Ross, I could just point out one thing that I'm not sure if you're familiar with the work of Anil Seth, but Anil Seth is a neuroscientist looking at consciousness. And his background, actually did a PhD in AI, and his theory is that we hallucinate the world. I mean, psychedelics is totally part of that. And I think this is another side of what's happening is actually, to my mind, is not just the kind of technical or the design capabilities, but the kind of theoretical thinking that open up, you know, in a fascinating new way. I see the present moment as a kind of rearticulation, but actually even more important than what was happening, let's say, in the 90s, when we were all looking at French philosophy, Derrida, Deleuze, and so on, and developing the computation in the office and creating all these new things. Now I think it's even more comprehensive and even more fascinating, and it goes right into understanding how the human mind works. It's absolutely...
And just a quick example of that, imagine where we are as a society, where in the pandemic, we can predict the financial outcome of the pandemic, but we cannot predict the mental damage of our population. Just that tells us where our heads are. We can predict the economics, but we cannot predict the all the mental health issues we're going to have in the world. And that's just... That can't happen with what's happening right now with AI. That's why I always say people have to get involved, because there's a lot of people that are great thinkers and they're like, no, I don't want to get involved. I don't like technology. I don't want technology. It's like, you have to get involved, because people that are amazing thinkers have to be part of this conversation, because unless they're part of this conversation, this will lead into a place.
Michael, there's an absolute reality here. You go online because you do a Zoom call with a doctor, which is absolutely ridiculous idea because they can't smell your breath or really look at the color of your eyes. So we're in that age now. And that doctor has Googled a few minutes before what I'm going to talk to him about anyway. So why don't I just do it myself? I would trust AI any day over these half-cooked people that we pay a fortune for. So bring it on. I think it's the creative process. We're talking about architecture and forms and stuff. But, you know, the implications are much broader than that. In terms of the quality of people's lives, to disseminate information and level up, I think there'll be an amazing democratic leveling up here that puts it at the fingertips of ordinary people who are being flattened at the moment. So, you know, and then they can walk in a city that you great architects are creating with those projections at night that just blow your mind, that maybe you can even see from space. I mean, just incredible, you know, algae growth across, you know, from space shuttle. It'd be amazing to see. Well, the space shuttle doesn't exist, but the thing is, we're past that. But that, you see what I mean? It's that, what are those environments that are open source for people in the world, so they enjoy it, they walk through it. But then what are their private personal experiences? How do you deal then with their own hopes and fears, you know, the utopia and dystopia of their lives? I think this is where the metaverse and everything can step in and give a degree of hope, as long as it doesn't cancel out our rainforest and it doesn't cancel out all the things which should help us retrospectively care about the things which feed us and nourish us.
But yeah, I mean, just sorry, Rafik, really quick. I just wanted to say that, for instance, with this tequila company in Mexico, we were convincing them that this, whatever happened in the distillery in the metaverse, would make to plant agave in real life in Oaxaca. So the relationship of something going on digitally in the metaverse out there has a direct impact positively in the world. So being responsible as designers to bridge those extensions for it to really have at least a pedagogical, it shared information and it grew here and it grew here. Oh, sorry, Rafi, go ahead.
I would just say that for some reason, metaverse as a canvas appeared much earlier than the substance generative AI. It feels like, you know, like there is this, someone mix up the order and then suddenly now it makes sense why we need this, you know, feeling.
I mean, for me, this, you know, what we're working on as well is, we started before metaverse and it integrates now nicely, is, you know, participatory design, user generated content and user feedback and encouraging users to co-create, and that's actually the best way, you know, substituting a kind of market research which you can never rely on, and also always forgets what's possible in the kind of combustive relationship between co-located users, and to make that as a metaverse experience and make that very intuitive, and then allow people to kind of be economic in terms of sharing certain spaces and adding value to who you're with and who you're next to. That's fantastically important in corporate clusters but also in residential clusters to overcome this anonymity and so on. And then, but also the metaverse version of these projects lives on, because you then continue to have that club virtually as well as physically, and you can have, you have hybrid there's hybrid events everywhere now. I mean, in education, in conferencing, in work. And for that, I think, and then for this kind of user integration and user co-creation, you need this intelligence, which is now locked up in our brains as experts. You need to kind of make it explicit and make that into tools and models, so that when they make choices, they get good information and good options. And I think that's an important part of making that credible. So not have it collapse into dilettantism, but have it a sophisticated, empowered user interfacing, user integration. And that's, I think, a part of it overall kind of democratization. And I think this is also this you know, really overcomes this a lot of the disadvantages of people. There's often the discussion, will there be a digital divide? But no, everybody around the world, even in homeless quarters and in Africa, they have mobile devices, they have internet. And I've just heard about, you know, in things like the Khan Academy, which has been having online schooling availability, and had, you know, across the world, they're integrating now with OpenAI, so to tailor in an interactive way the delivery of knowledge, of content, of learning with dialogically with the local school class and individuals and so on and so forth. And that's often there's a certain kind of social force and utopian thrill in this work, and I'm excited by this, and I don't see any kind of a problem with us being pushed out of work, because these systems yet have to be created, and and we can expand our client base and our kind of what we can deliver to the world. The more we can integrate, let's say, user experiences and user participation, I think that's a wonderful opportunity, and it needs these AI systems, because otherwise they won't be not credible, or the result wouldn't be sophisticated.
But I have a doubt about the metaverse. I also want to discuss about this part, even though today is about the AI. But I think maybe in metaverse is more threatened to architects than AI. The reason is in metaverse, everyone can build with AI, but not in the real world. And normal people, even kids, control the AI power in metaverse, there's nothing to do with architects at all.
That's not my experience. No. I think because, look, there will be not everybody will, in the end, you will participate, but you not everyone will be a kind of solitary creator of their own environments. And you have a lot of institutions, schools, firms, businesses, fashion houses. They need venues, they need conferencing. So there's so much, I think there's an explosion of work. So I think any architect, because we are the ones who will, I think, be primary in there. It's not has little to do with video gaming. So it's not going to be the game developers, I think, which will capture the market. There's a huge technology transfer from game industry into this new world. But I foresee this, what you're talking about it. I don't see that at all. At least for the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years, it's going to be more work for architects than you. We're going to be an avalanche of work. And since there's so many to be done, I think it's very important that we think about empowering user generation, user participation, but it will not be taking over, but it will be very important on the fringes of delivery. And whoever can harness this, I think will thrive. But I think the amount of work we have to imagine is so massive that the current kind of profession would be totally swamped and couldn't cope with it at all. So that's the way I see it.
I totally agree. There's a large amount of demands needed in metaverse, but AI can really help on this with the, absolutely. I mean, basically everyone can do it. But if we understand or if we all agree that the architecture is not about the forms and shapes and the environment, and then in the real world, architects have more value, can help different roles to fulfill their aspects, and we can design a system to manage all the demands, and which is in the metaverse does not exist, because the metaverse is just the forms. You just need to enjoy the environment, the virtual environment, the machine created. So
when I spend time in China, and I'm really deep in China, and I see those horrendous concrete blocks, totally dehumanizing. I mean, that's what people can afford.
Okay? Yeah, that is the stage of developing in the early ways. Yeah.
Well, I think your work could change that. I think your work could change that. That's my reading.
Yeah, thank you.
But it's a public and private domain here. I think in the private domain, where you don't have space, you have a box. The idea of escapism in the metaverse is something which is fundamentally going to happen, because people are going to use.
I totally agree with the metaverse.
They create their own environment, and then they're going to look outward, and then the public spaces in the will be incredible, because those are the places you go, and people will congregate and coagulate in those spaces and really share, and then they'll go back to their own box. But that box won't be a box as we know it. That will be basically a television.
I also believe, of course, there will be, you know, panoramic mega screens where you have, where you join virtual and physically co-located audiences in this kind of, let's say, cyber-physical fusion. So I see a lot of that happening. But yeah, there's a kind of so much of a remaking that I think we as designers can be excited about it, and we need to gear up with these tools. That was my main message. And I do think there's a lot of functionality in these spaces. They need to, you know, they're not just thrills and experiences. That's where you have seminars, conferences, productive meetings, a lot of them hybrid meetings. You have socialize, but that also has purposes. So that also can be, you know, it has to be engaging. It has to function very well in terms of finding each other in different settings, and the acoustic has to work properly. And there's so much, let's say, design functionality required that this will, that this is, you know, you can have degrees of user participation, but highly guided and highly kind of managed systems, which we need to create with the help of AI. That's the way I foresee it. So yeah, I don't see the professionals who are, that avalanche of work coming towards us, we really don't have to worry about being out of work. We have to be worried about, you know, being able to cope with that. And it will draw a lot of new people into the profession, I think, as well, which I find exciting. So in terms of, as an architectural teacher, I foresee that the schools of architecture will mushroom because design will be, will have a kind of, a huge kind of wave of new as maybe as the doctors kind of recede, the architects and designers will ascend.
Yeah, I totally agree that the metaverse is gonna be the trend. I just think that it's nothing to do with architects anymore, because of the jobs you're calling, maybe in the future will be named as the dream maker. It's not architect.
No, I don't believe that, actually.
Okay, but maybe can I pick up on that, Renu? Because I think one of the implications of what you were suggesting is that you can evaluate a design using AI. Now, that automatically, I think, challenges not necessarily the architect, but the licensing and the registration of an architect, which I think is already kind of old-fashioned. I mean, with a situation, I think, in Patrick's office where, you know, there's a disclaimer because, I mean, there's, you know, the term architect, dot, 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 because you're operating internationally. But these things are so incredibly parochial, especially in the States, where NCARB, you're registered to operate in one state. I mean, how old-fashioned is that? You know, and I think what it seems to me to suggest that maybe that logic of licensing, where you get the name architect and you're approved to be able to, makes no sense anymore. It's a question of how the project itself, submitting it for approval. In fact, maybe you don't even need to submit it for approval, because if you're using the right software, it already conforms to all those constraints.
Interesting, because, you know, to be a practicing architect, of course, you've got to get that stamp of approval, you know, RIBA, whatever, the full thing. Whereas people like Thomas Heatherwick, I understand, Thomas is not an architect, and yet look what he's doing. I mean, he's guiding a ship. So I think this, what's interesting there is it will break down the definition. I still think I like the name architect, but I still, it's got with it a rather fuggy connotation too. And, you know, when people say to me, oh, what do you do? And I say, I'm a designer, they don't know where to begin, because it's such a nebulous profession these days. And I always say I'm an evolutionary biologist, and actually people understand that. So yeah, whatever. But we're missing with these new terminologies, I think there will be new professions, you know. So it's not this degeneration of previous professions. It's just a replacement therapy with a new vocabulary. I think that's fine.
I mean, the technical and execution work we're talking about, with Vanyu is talking about, many architects don't get involved with this anymore. They are specialized. It's basically engineering ways of working and execution and contractors. We still do it, there's only one motivation for us to do it, and we're only doing one aspect, the final touch and feel and artistic and phenomenological experience. We want to maintain that only in the last millimeter of the surface of encounter. And behind the hood, as it were, there's a lot of things which are no longer part of us. And And that will translate one-to-one into the metaverse, where all the engineering stack is substituted, but there is engineering and there is functionality. So it's the same in industrial design. You are the one who's in charge of the look, feel, utility, user interface, the interface designers, and then you have your engineers, your production managers, your and those who are in charge of the physics. But the designers are not in charge of the physics anymore. And although, as I said, a lot of architects don't even touch that aspect. And we have within our firms, we have these groups, these BIM experts and BIM team who deal with final executions. We like to maintain involved. Why? Because we want to have that final feel. But we be highly selective of what technical aspects remain. You know, everything which has an impact potentially on that final phenomenology is what we're really interested in. And of course, organizational issues of how the crowds shift and move are important part of it too. But this is all front end design, and mostly so that's, I think, is the essence of architecture. So I think when Vanya is talking, she hasn't fully grasped the radical kind of distillation and separation of architecture and engineering. They collaborate, but there's very distinct responsibilities. And the responsibilities we have as architects in the built environment design, they go, and with all the competencies are required in a way in the metaverse design. They're not dreams, they're actually real ongoing social reality seamlessly between physical and virtual. It's the same social reality. I'm not talking about movies and entertainment escape. I'm talking about productive lives. Meaningful social lives, political debates, conferences, learning environments, collaboration and co-creation is also what we're starting to do. We now kind of co-create in virtual spaces. We have a kind of digital version of a Beijing office, and we have, you know, and we start working on having 3D models where you sketch over 3D and you roam around and you gather around the model. This has been in the making for quite a long time. Separately, and that comes in the metaverse. Now, I think this is so. I think this is a social reality which is, and we need to look at what I'm also very interested in, the way this integrates. When we design physical buildings, we should at the same time design the virtual spaces and the interfaces where we have these big screens. And you're right, Ross. The home kind of will be, you're living in this in a cave, in a VR cave to some extent, or at least parts of your rooms. Rather than, you know, you're not going to go into having laptop screens as the only input and communication device into this metaverse. And I've seen spaces where literally you have a meeting room and you have a huge floor-to-ceiling panoramic screen around that, and that's where you have where the table continues. That's what we're working on, and I think that means to some extent the metaverse is integrated directly then in that case into the physical and urban spaces, because they can become interfaces into these virtual worlds. And we're living in both of them at the same time. And I think that's very exciting. But it really opens up a huge amount of design requirement. And that's what I'm talking about. And I see, you know, the AI, those architects and designers who are exploring the AI, the young firms and young designers, et cetera, they're the ones who will also be, they're exploring now the metaverse as their new realm. Because precisely what is exciting, and I'm saying this as a well-established firm, that might be certain risk in this new kind of exploratory world, there's a lot of newcomers, a lot of savvy and younger people who in the normal realm of big real estate, they have to wait 25 years. They have to build up the track record and notch up. That is not necessarily required, and that will be undermined. And I don't feel threatened still, and I somehow welcome it, because my thinking isn't, what can I grab and hold on to? I'm just love the way the doors are kind of pushed open, and I have a competitive nature. I don't think I'm going to go under so quickly.
It's so interesting, Patrick. I mean, really, unless anybody wants to jump in, I didn't want to take over there. But what's so interesting now is that you carry everything within you, really. I mean, it's you. And I don't mean that in an egocentric way. I just mean that you reach a point where you've got to give back. And what I'm finding is there's a young generation of designers who don't know how to apply themselves. There are no clients. There's no enlightened clients. I mean, you can't all rest upon LG and Samsung or a few others. You can't. It's this, they aren't there. So you have to have a sort of startup mentality. And so I'm developing probably the biggest design studio on earth, because I have all these young people coming to me who love what I say. They love what I do. They love my design language, and they want to be part of it. So you collaborate, you coexist, and it's a form of education. So these are people from Sendai to wherever they are, to around the world. It's a form of education and dialogue, but I'm realizing that this bandwidth of people who are in their 20s have a great consciousness. They have great language skills, by the way. It doesn't matter what their language is, their foundation language. They can communicate. And also ChatGPT is really helping that too. So there's no barriers anymore. So you can really be influential. Now, the second thing was that Patrick was talking about was this thing where, you know, ultimately, I think you don't want to disappoint. And what these new tools that we're working with give is this radical resolution. And that obviously that applies very much to what Refik's doing. This is just mind-blowing. I mean, it just takes your bone structure and pulls it out through your ears. It's incredible. So, you know, it's like for years, I've never understood why companies make a concept car and then they don't make it, because all they're doing is disappointing their audience. I mean, you can't buy what you see. And what man thinks should become reality. If they can make one work, why can't they make it? So you can't go through into the future with disappointment. And what I think these practices, like, you know, Zaha's practice as such has done over the years, is force that through. I mean, when I came to launch at Soho there in Beijing, I was blown away, because these were surfaces that, yes, you can imagine, but how the hell do you build them? And I think there's a secondary layer here of opportunity in the world for how we deal with material sciences and how we interact with that to build the things that the mind can envision through these new tools. And that's another thing. And by the way, most of those materials, you know, I give a lecture called Out of This World, which is supposed to be, wow, out of this world, but it's actually out of this world, because it's basically minerals, it's sand, it's some rock, you know, whatever. And, you know, you walk past a television or a car and you think, nobody's even given it any thought. But it's unbelievable where that comes from. So, you know, man's ability to manipulate and to, you know, engineer our planet or re-engineer is something we're not going back on. We're going to understand it at a nano level, and then we're going to put it back in whichever way we put it back. Artificial systems.
Could we bring Daniel in here? We've been talking about the younger generation. I'm not sure Daniel's so young anymore, but he's a newly appointed academic from Atlantic University. He's still completing his PhD under Patrick and so on. But Daniel, would you like to contribute?
Well, yeah, for me, like the discussion with Metaverse, I mean, I'm not that involved right now in Metaverse. So, but I see in a way this kind of idea of almost like the idea of digital twin and trying to, in a way, have a sort of replica of reality somehow, and then learning from that somehow. But for me, like bringing it back to also empathy, what Mikhail was talking about, like, you know, I think with this kind of technology, we finally have the chance of bringing all these kind of aspects of what it means to experience design. We have the chance now to bring all of those together in a way. With all the other technologies like computation, it was a great idea, but it was extremely like unpractical. You cannot do it. And even if you do it, you cannot apply it at scale in a way. So I think Refik, for example, you're already working in Metaverse when it comes to also other senses, not only like, you know, visual or something. Yeah, you're also looking at other senses. And I think when it comes to design, that's also an important aspect, like to try to understand design holistically in a way. I think John Fraser had a discussion with Neil at one point, and he was just saying, you know, like you have this kind of Midjourney images, and people are using Midjourney and they type in Zaha Hadid and you end up with images. And he was like, well, but those are not Zaha Hadid, you know, because Zaha Hadid building, it's also crowd simulation, it's also this and also that, all those kind of things. And I think this ties together also with a discussion of 3D, for example. So if you talk about 3D as representation only, well, you cannot carry all the meaningful information that gets into defining a 3D just by using the shell of 3D in a way. So somehow you have to bring all that information in. And we finally have now the technology that allows us to do that. We have the technology that allows us to bring crowd simulation together with organization, together with envelope, together with environmental and so on, together with empathy and all these kind of aspects. And some we have now, we can translate that perhaps in metaverse. My concern right now with metaverse is mostly that it's just superficial in a way, application of what we describe as 3D, but it's not bringing actually defines the quality space, because it's just taking the 3D and generating things. Let's say if we use AI in that kind of way. But if we bring it from this kind of perspective of not only visual, but also like senses and also 3D and also information, the flow in that space, all those kind of things, then I think that's an amazing resource. And I think I'm coming from this, like I was showing you my presentation, from this kind of idea of neuroscience had for a long time this kind of brain-centric approach to intelligence. And everything that we define as intelligence mostly comes through that. And this is the problem also with language models. We believe that language is enough to describe all the intelligence that it's encoded into something, which is not. When we experience the world, if I experience this object, my experience with this object is not just visual. It's the fact that I'm able to touch this object, I'm able to see it, I'm able to have a relation, my body to that object. And these three together define, in a way, my experience to this object. I think the same happens also with architecture. It's not only a sense like aesthetical or so on. There are multiple senses. And suddenly now we have the chance with this technology, we have the chance to bring all those together. Empathy and so all that, all those now are possible. And I think it's great, like right now, Rafiq, you're doing this kind of metaverse kind of idea where you start to bring other senses. And then once we start to collect more data and we start to, in a way, bring that into reality, I think that's where things, exciting things are going to happen.
Just very briefly, I think sound is very important. And now, Unreal Engine 5 and some of our metaverse, we're going into the spatial sound, and you have, ability to simulate as you have a sound generation, you have chatting, you have movement of people, you have music, other kind of ambient noises, and the way they reverberate, it depends very much. You can guess. We have a very high-tuned sensibility of understanding where things are coming from, where things are located, how large the space is, and what the quality and character of the and that tells also about the atmosphere and situation we're entering. I think it's incredibly important. It's like the shift from silent movies to full sound movies, and that will happen. I think, again, this will be explored first in the metaverse, but I think this will also be we will integrate this into our design. Acoustic design becomes now a lighting design. It's part of the phenomenology and semiology of the built environment, because we start to be able to simulate it. And since we can render and sophisticated light conditions, we really can play and work with this and iterate over this. And that will be the same with sound, I believe. But I see the metaverse very much strong as a vehicle for pushing it forward. And the other project I've been thinking about for many years, as you know, Daniel, is responsive environments, interaction, reconfiguration in an AI empowered built environment where all the elements, whether it's the light and doors and windows and openings and paravents and furnishings, are AI empowered learning, robotic co-collaborators. And again, this project is very hard to pull off. And it's still stuck in the art world with, something like Jason Bruges creating this wonderful, sophisticated installation, but they're not being functionalized because it's a leap. It's a too big of a step. But in the metaverse, I think this will come. We will learn how to, and we have to think the metaverse as highly functioning systems where these things will be strategically, performatively employed. And so a lot of what we've been developing over the years as responsive environments, I think we will implement them first in the metaverse. And then a lot of designers get used to it, clients get used to it, how they feel. And I think that is the stepping stone for bringing it into the real world. And you can have enormous flexibility and efficiency gains instead of having all the settings spread out next to each other, you can have one, you know, a few of them overlapping and transforming into each other. And so there I see a role, but I think it's more than that. I wouldn't, you have to, I think you're gonna call it this to be somewhat superficial. I think we will live both physical and virtual spaces and in their interfaces. And I think it will be the, but they will, that also will change the physical spaces. And it will empower the design, you know, this guy will be probably more of a protagonist than I'm eventually, but this is what I believe in. So I think the architects, I see kind of certain resistance as if there was, I see all the design disciplines being one discourse, you know, whether it's industrial design, graphic design, interface design as well. I mean, it's all about framing, communicative interaction, the design in a way, orienting and bringing it together, configuring us. And I think interface design, that's where Apple actually had more to offer than the pure minimalism. On the iMac, when the icons swell as you push your cursor around, this kind of parametric, there was a parametricism interface designer, when you click on a folder and it kind of, it zooms away, and that's to remember where it goes. So there's certain degrees of, and this interface design, I think, is in the end going to be three-dimensionalized, and it's really part of our world. We should it's about, that's the design discourse, and the sub-disciplines within designs are less important than design versus engineering, for instance, or design versus art as an abstracted laboratory. It feeds into both these, engineering and art feed into design, and all the design disciplines at the same time. And you could see it very clearly since the Bauhaus, where all the disciplines were united, as well as you had these kind of side feeders into this. That's what I believe in, and we have to accept that the metaverse is our domain, and it's not escapism, it's not designing a dream, it's designing social reality. And we have to embrace
I'll take it a step further, Patrick, because I even though I love the metaverse, I think that a lot of people paused the metaverse a little bit because AI was advancing too quick. I hope personally that with AI, this you're going to love, Ross. We're talking about, since I started studying architecture, I was always in conflict of putting something on Earth, that you would scrape the Earth and attach something to a living being. So we're studying at the office, like, why would I have something attached to my body? If it's this watch that gives me my oxygen levels, if it gives me my heart rate, then I might want it to have be attached to my body when I decide to have it. So can AI take us to a moment where we're reading the soil beneath the building? What's my relationship with this building to the earth? What am I reading from the earth with their artificial intelligence or AGI that we were talking, also Angelica was asking. So that moment where we can take the technology to understand our relationship, because we are nature. You were talking about how we see nature. We are nature. But we've always, I don't know why, but there's always been kind of this disconnect, like go and see nature. It's like, no, we are nature. We just detached ourselves for some stupid reason. But when architecture or design or whatever we do has an intrinsic relationship to the planet we're living in and the way it reads, I think it's going to be a beautiful moment. And I hope it's not going to be in the metaverse. I hope it's going to be in the physical world that could feed off to the metaverse back and forth as well.
Maybe I can just chip in one, just to kind of slightly change the focus in some ways. It seems to me, introduced the question of education. It seems to me this is in the real crisis right now. We've got a world that is changing, not just week by week, but day by day, hour by hour. You know, it's actually the goalpost is shifting. And how on earth do we operate in that world in terms of education, where only, I mean, it seems to me this forum itself is possibly part of the solution, whereby you bring everyone together, all the kind of the leading figures in the world on a single platform, accessible to everyone around the world. That's the kind of crucial thing, known recorded as a video that you can whatever. But, you know, it seems to me like that the model we have at the moment of these kind of professors, some of whom frankly are dinosaurs, you know, talking to individual people in a certain sort of way, in an isolated fashion, unaware of what's going on. We almost need to draw upon the collective intelligence of what's happening right now, the leading figures who are immediately kind of trying to shift the 2D to 3D. I mean, some of the stuff we had in the tutorials with George Gila and so on and Daniel Escobar was absolutely mind-blowing. It's almost, this is the only way we can educate anymore, is by having a kind of global classroom, a single platform whereby you can share these ideas all over the world.
And by the way, such as so much wisdom, I was just listening and thinking so much, but I have one super interesting point of view, maybe coming from a very far away, from Amazonia, Brazil. So me and my wife, we have been like pretty much closely researching indigenous wisdom for many purposes. But what I was not sure that, for example, we have been dreaming about rainforest-focused, a very advanced AI model for many, many years. But what was missing for us was like, I mean, who is protecting our lungs? Like, who is living there? And who is doing this for which purpose? And then we lived with this incredible family, Yavanava family, in their houses, in their second village for 1,000 years, with the most primitive architecture you can ever imagine. And it was so powerful, and it was so minimal. And going back to fundamentals, to remember where we are coming while living, not reading on a like a history book or a Discovery Channel, but really physically go there with all the fears, like jaguars and piranhas or like whatever, and really live with them and hear their wisdom, was a mind-opening moment. So we dedicate our next research to their wisdom, and they're advising our journey with AI. And I didn't expect such a wisdom from a family of just 1,000 people that barely have technology, that they need nothing at all. They live under 20 years, no cancer, no diabetics, like no COVID deaths, nothing. We all construct our problems by ourselves, and we are solving our own problems. What I would like to think for many, hopefully, people is, sometimes ancestral wisdom or something that we were looking for comes from the most underappreciated or not respected yet cultures. I do believe ancestral future. I think the future is ancestral. I do believe that we will eventually come back to the basics to give more meaning and depth to these like tools and worlds. So if you're interested, happy to share more about rainforest. And I'm sure Patrick, and like we can imagine worlds together for people who have a different worldview. But I just want to thank you so much. I need to go back to the MoMA to fix AI. but deeply grateful to be here with your wisdom, Ross, Daniel, Patrick, and Michael, and of course, Neil, and everyone, one of you. Thank you for inviting.
Okay. Great to be here with you. Take care. See you soon. Ciao.
Take care.
See you, Refik.
Thank you, Refik. Terrific as always. Terrific. We should try and wrap up, but I would just like to maybe open up to some final thoughts and things.
Can I come in on that? At the beginning, when I had my 5 minutes, I talked about three levels. There's the smart, there's the intelligent, and then there's the wisdom. And I was just thinking, as Refik was speaking, and it's very important that he came in on that subject, because I think it can all coexist. It has to. And I'm hoping that this broader level of understanding and this explosion of intelligence will actually settle things down. I mean, that's my hope, because I don't see enough logic in humans. There's other things that come into play which override the logic. One is the use of fossil fuels, which, as we know, the consequence of that. So what Refik is saying is very important, but at the same time, I think it should be something which this rewilding can also relate to what we're talking about with the biodiversity of the design that we do or do not do. You know, we've got to cancel out some stuff as a balancing out. And, you know, there's nothing unattractive or uncool about dealing with issues related to our environment, because ultimately, we're not going to have any food. We're not going to be topsoil. We're not going to have, you know, there are some big things coming in here. So embedding, you know, when I sit in on these juries and stuff or reviews at the EA or whatever, you know, I think, well, you know, if you just perforated that building and made it responsible for its own carbon emissions, it wouldn't make it ugly. It'd make it kind of incredible, you know? So it's just this thing where bringing it all together with that convergence is an opportunity, and it should be in our hearts and minds of the people, like not only ourselves, but the people that we influence, to not forget, because contemporary life is all about detachment, you know. But if those very low energy walls in somebody's terrible apartment in some place in China that's 30 square meters can give them a vision in real time of events in the rainforest, maybe that's not a bad thing. So I don't know. I don't want to come in and bang that drum, because it's a difficult one. But equally, I don't think what we should talk about is being prescriptive, because there's another world there. And by the way, it wasn't very long ago that we were very primitive. This acceleration is unreal, what we're talking about. And I went in to see the Ai Weiwei. There was an opening at the Design Museum. Sorry, Patrick, I wanted you to come, but they had a terrible door policy, and they I couldn't convince them of how important you were.
Ai Weiwei.
Yeah, ridiculous, isn't it? But anyway, you know, what he shows, I think, is incredibly relevant. You know? And I thought, well, how can I unite? So I just go online, I write, you know, AI or not AI, is that the question? You know, just pull it up a little bit. But we need the art mindset and debate, as well as architectural debate and all these other debates, the philosophical debate, the people who write, the people who think, the scientists, you know. And by the way, when you do go to places like SpaceX and they are 3D printing titanium parts that are hybrid between the organic and the linear, oh, it makes your skin, you know, it's creepy, it's fantastic. It's so, it has such an amazing level of an awareness. So what I'm saying is that within the realm of design and how you build things, strangeness is a consequence of innovative thinking. I've always said that, and that will come as what this AI and all of the other inputs that we're talking about, what will bring is a breaking free from what Patrick was talking about, the sort of Bauhauses and the, what is modernism? I thought the word modernism means today, you know. I didn't think it's something from the last century. So we need new vocabularies as a replacement so that we start talking a new language. New language will mean new experiences, new output.
Sure.
Yeah, just also picking up where you were talking, Rost, about the idea of, to me, I mean, when people or clients come and say, hey, let's do a self-sufficient building, to me it's like, can we please stop talking about self and talk about others? Why are we still talking about my building being zero, net zero? No, give something back. Produce something that you give back to the community, that you give back to nature. So instead of leaving no trace, leave it much better than you picked it up. We passed that moment of let's leave no trace. No, no, no. We have to now make it better. Otherwise, this thing about sustaining the planet as it is, it's like we can't sustain it as it is. We already proven that we need to talk about regenerative solutions. And regenerative means let's make it better. So, I mean, just a wrap up again. I don't want to be the one always pulling back to us as humans, but first of all, we're humans. Independent on what each of us, our creative output is happening or coming out to the world. And we should kind of just reflect on what are we doing to push again against the rapid advancement of technology, or better said, no, the urgency to accelerate human conscious evolution in this transformative world. I mean, how are we balancing that act to make sure that the right people are here having the same conversation as we were talking about? Not just designers, not just philosophers, not, I mean, everybody has to get involved. It's our future. Otherwise, this, I mean, everybody, we all know a lot of people talking about how wrong this can go. So let's make sure it doesn't go in the wrong direction, no?
Well, I don't think it can go wrong in physical structures like architecture. I don't, because I think it's just there. It has a kind of awareness. I think it's gonna help us get rid of food packaging and plastic bags and all those other things which we just accept and don't question, because AI will come in and it will eradicate anything which doesn't make any sense. And I like that aspect of AI. I think there needs we need to use it as pure logic, away from greed, selfish thinking, nationalism, whatever it is. And that's that for me is a really profound thing. And that will then liberate us to explore all these other things that we're talking about. You know, I mean, a car could be made from recycled cardboard if inside you've got the most amazing experience, which you can do. I mean, I'm not, I'm just, that's a provocation, but you understand what I'm saying? Is that I just think there's other ways to look. It won't be, because we're really accelerating towards an age of hyper precision in the way that we make things. So, I don't want to sound too dry, but you know, I'm there at the leading edge of how we make things and why we make them and why we shouldn't make them, in order to leave space and time and energy for those other things, which perhaps give us a more collective experience. I think it's very important.
Yeah, I mean, maybe my last words, when we're talking about all these environmental issues, I think we as a group, we have this kind of technology optimism, and we're the ones who believe in progress and technology progress to solve these problems, and must reject the kind of hunkering down the degrowth ideology, because and I believe also in, you know, as we're seeing the fantastic kind of voluntary zero carbon commitments, you don't need necessarily governments to come down and set up targets, which are, and you have these fantastic rewilding, reforestering through zero carbon commitment mediated through carbon markets, free carbon markets, regenerative. And I do believe that, you know, politically, if anything, we should open up degrees of freedom. I think we would then see a concentration in larger cities. I think the whole of the UK could converge onto London, and you more or less rewild most of it. I mean, it came to me recently when I've, you know, the startup culture is generating all the solutions, when it's in energy and for instance, in vertical farming, you have, you know, you plug a vertical farm, you could bring it underground into the city, you know, you with AI, you can fine calibrate the lighting to have perfect growth, you have no in pesticides, you get 25 harvests per year instead of maybe one or two. With the perfect product, which lasts longer in on the shelves. So all of these issues, I think, are really important. And for that, we need an open global communication, a debate, which needs to be very frank and honest, and not kind of shy off and hunkered down by too many sensitivities, and also criticizing and comparing cultures and solutions, and involving AI and developing solutions, what you said, Ross, beyond the human imagination, because that's where we can enhance that. So that's, I think, that's my view. I'm kind of a view of where I trust in technology and entrepreneurship and ingenuity, and now in terms of AI empowered. And we have to. I mean, this you have, if you think about these new AI systems, the hardware that we have to build for them, there's a kind of funneling of certain resources. If we weren't growing economically, that would have to be kind of pulled away from everybody's current standard of living. And these are already at the edge. You can see what happens in France when they had fuel taxes, or now when you have to increase a kind of pension age. So there is not much scope. Only through growth can we solve all these problems. And then I think we can, and for that we need the degrees of freedom, we need entrepreneurship, we need the technology optimism, and we need to, you know, that's my final word, we need to allow and the not only degrees of freedom, but I plead as well for taking a little bit more risk for the sake of reward and investment on many levels. So I mean, we don't get into this, but I'm kind of not somebody who wants to have a moratorium on AI research. I think full on and all these kind of heartbreaks or the political some kind of worries coming in and blocking things and stopping things, and I think that would be the catastrophe. We need to be kind of open and free and energized and optimistic, I think, to solve these issues, which are serious issues, of course, serious issues and risks and agendas we need to face, but we cannot face them by prevention, by moratoria, by stoppages, by by heavy regulation. That's my plea.
I don't think it's incidental that the inertia of everything that we're talking about is within the recent period, and we talk about artificial intelligence mainly, but the inertia of that and its absolute incredible acceleration, I think it's not incidental. I think it realizes that there is a certain urgency over the next maybe three decades. So what I think is positive here, backing up what we're talking about, is this idea that it gives us more time. It gives us more time because of that acceleration to have a go, you know, at any of these aspects and fail and go again and fail and guide it. That's a really positive thing, I think. If you take the last 6 or 9 months and you multiply that by the next 5 years, and 5 years is a blip, well, as long as we're feeding in the right sensibility, without the arrogance, the hedonism, and the decadence, which often comes with a lot of this stuff, and it comes back to the original presentations that we were sharing, is that a lot of the stuff that I see that is being popped up on Instagram is just so terribly repetitive, and by people who are trying to just get a job with Dior or Chanel or whatever it is, and I think it's the wrong focus. And I think let's pop a few things in there that actually divert the gaze within this next period to things which holistically integrate all of these aspects that we're talking about. And I think it's possible, I really do, because we're committed. I mean, that's the problem, is we're fully committed. You know, we're committed to go to the moon, we're committed to go to Mars, we're going to walk there, we're going to do whatever we're going to do. And, you know, and what are we going to do, suddenly live like troglodytes somewhere? It's not going to happen, is it? No. So we embrace it, but actually feed in a few of these incredibly salient, important, you know, Michael's points, very humanistic things. And by the way, I'm a bit tired of that word too, because there are other species on Earth, and it's always always humans. And I'm sorry, you know. So I wish there was another terminology for that too. You know, are we part of the flora or the fauna or what the hell are we?
Naturalists.
No, my clothes on. But you see what I mean?
Artificialists.
Yeah.
Because we have new brothers.
That's right.
Arthur Block actually said in 1964 exactly what you said, that the human as the carbon nature might be replaced by the machines in the future because we are too stupid.
Well, you don't sound stupid, so you're not going to be replaced, I don't think.
No, we should love and respect our creations.
Yeah, but I just had a thought when you were speaking, Patrick. Wouldn't it be interesting, because it is possible now, is that, you know, you've got children, you know, wouldn't it be interesting if you could talk to your future self and create your future self? You can download all of you, and then you can have a dialogue with your past self. And I think by having a dialogue between the future and now, you would make better decisions, you know, and I think that is possible to anticipate and predict. The predictive nature of minds is really important. We're the only species that does that, you know. So that's,
yeah. Now we're generating a species that does that too. I mean, what happens now is just to be with GPT-4. There's this kind of additional tool called reflection, where you allow the system to reconsider and reevaluate its previous utterances and learn up. In some sort of autocatalytic kind of reflective learning, fascinating things. There's this has to be fueled, and we can't have centralized control. It's just crazy. All the innovations we're talking about. I mean, I'm connected up with this fantastic network of startup companies, and I'm sitting always in these presentations for the prizes of the fastest, the best, the this and that, the newest, particularly in the intersection between energy and computation. And they're all startup companies from all over the place, and they're bringing the solutions. So I was just talking about these kind of fantastic vertical farming cooked on into using excess energy from power stations, or we're talking about a new invention, and they're coming out of the UK. I mean, this is not UK based, but out of kind of backwaters like Scotland, developing tools for optimizing server energy where you have cooling directly built into the, not cooling that whole huge box and building, but cooling into the machines, into the computers, et cetera, et cetera. So there's enormous innovations and savings, and you, and we need that flourish. And there's no way of centralizing and thinking that we can control that. And so I'm fascinated also the way AI and computation is kind of inbuilt into the chip production itself. There was this fantastic video you should see from NVIDIA, where you can see the amount of computation which goes on, and then also rationalizing on that huge savings. And because these kind of the chip production is an unbelievable kind of thing, a machine, $250 million. A dollar right there, and the energy consumption there. So it's kind of, it's, these are physical systems, mm-hmm. And they need a lot of investment resource, but they're also optimizing. So in the end, economic growth is not necessarily connected with ever more material consumption. It's a lot is connected with less and less. That's your point of dematerialization. But dematerialization is not a kind of pulling back and going back to nature, back to basics, Amazon forest, but it's precisely of optimizing these systems, and you have a continuous value growth. That's utility. That's life opportunities, life chances, and you measure them in the market, and that you want that product, but it's actually has less materials substance to it. Its intelligence is cheaper energetically, it's et cetera, its utilization is, you know, of that piece of work is multiplied billion for billion people through a download. That's all economic growth. And but that cannot be, I'm just putting that out there, because in that environmental issues, we have on the one hand, the people talking about moratoriums and AI, we have the new Green Deal talking about centralizing and controlling. For the sake of the planet, I don't think we can save the planet this way. We have to trust. We have to trust in bottom-up entrepreneurial processes, and don't be scared. Don't be scared. We have a cultural discourse. Mm-hmm. We have markets and discourses. And these discourses rip through Twitter, through Facebook, through all the media and so on, and Substack and so on. And that's what I trust in. Mm-hmm. And that's my plea. So maybe is this... It becomes political in the last 2 minutes of this session, but I think it is, because we can see already the forces lining up to impose centralized political controls. I don't want the Congress, members of parliament, etc., which they totally would be overburdened to deal with it, to come in and try to kind of channel that. That's not what I believe in.
Just add here. I mean, personally, because if we are talking about this kind of like moratorium on AI and so on, yeah, like because this is something super recent right now, there is a big discussion about that. So personally, I see it almost like equivalent of saying, let's have a moratorium on the internet before the internet even became something, you know. So I think I understand there are challenges with AI and there are dangers, and I think everyone working with AI should keep in mind and try to safeguard in a way for those kind of issues. But I think to have this kind of approach of, you know, limiting the internet before it's even something, I think that's problematic. Yeah, I think
that's a critical discourse can deliver that.
Yeah, as we were discussing at the beginning, like the explosion of creativity that emerges out of just this like 6-7 months of, you know, OpenAI, DALL-E and Midjourney and so on, it's insane. Yeah, so for me it's like, why would you stop that? We haven't even yet reached a point where we actually know what we are doing with these things and how these are going to really help. So to stop this now, I think it's really like it's missing the point, maybe, yeah. And whatever.
We need to kind of wrap things up. Michel's got to kind of head to the airport. And I'm at the same time, I'm convinced that time is the kind of crucial issue here. I'm always reminded of Wolf Pricks's lecture title, in 2 days' time, tomorrow will be yesterday. And I think, you know, and certainly tomorrow, today will be yesterday. This world is going so quickly. This has been such an incredible session. I don't think we've answered any of the questions. we certainly have raised important ethical and other concerns, and I think we've put the human at the center of all these things. And I think, to my mind, that has always been the case, that in some senses, AI is becomes a mirror in which we can understand what it is to be human and also to valorize the importance of the human. I'm reminded of that sort of shot of the blue marble planet. When they went into space, the first thing they realized was how fragile and beautiful the Earth is. And we hadn't seen it before, and suddenly we realized that. I think we're now beginning to sort of understand what are the crucial issues that we need to address, and I don't know what the answers are. I almost feel like, you know, in the speed of change, since the beginning of this session, I think the world has changed completely. There's something new come out in AI, and almost everything is will be out of date soon. I would love to try and get this team together, this group together in a few months' time, and the world will be completely different. But it's been a real honor and a privilege to be with such great minds, with such creative minds today, that I think it's been an astonishing thing. I will just leave you with one thought, and that is to say that I don't know if you were, I used to be a Latin scholar, right? I translated Alberti from Latin. The word computare means to think together. And I think what we've got today was a kind of a swarm intelligence, a kind of thinking together of some of the great minds, which has really contributed to an enormous amount. And the fact that we can deliver this and offer this to people around the world is really a fantastic thing to do. I just want one final thing. I'm going to share a screen just to go and remind people hold on a second. Just to give a clue, so most of our contributors today are so rock faves, rock stars, you don't need to look them up, but I just want to simply say there are some Instagram accounts. Refik has his Instagram account, Ross has his Instagram account, Michelle has his Instagram account, and Daniel has both his own one and also the Co-op Himmelblau one, the Digital Futures one, and my own one. I would also emphasize that on this YouTube channel down here, we put everything, including all these tutorials that have been going on the last few weeks, which have been absolutely mind-blowing. So just to kind of wrap up this particular series, and I would just make say also tomorrow we have a session on architecture and philosophy with a session on Julia Kristeva, but just to say that this has been an incredible sort of resource for everyone. I want to thank everyone for contributing to this. This is where we're going into the future together. And I think this idea of sharing our passion, sharing ideas, sharing everything has been so productive. And thank you so much. I also want to simply sort of say thank you to the rest of the team who have been behind her, especially my colleague Angelico, who's been part of making this happen, Daniela, who's been making the posters, and Gustavo and the rest of the team, also the team in Bilibili, who've been live streaming this in China alongside this. I always say that the digital futures, it's a bit like an iceberg. All we see is the 10% at the top, but there's a lot going beneath that. But it's wonderful that we're able to come together and share our passion this way. And I think this is the only way we can actually really make things operate in a world that is changing so rapidly, is by sharing a platform and sharing ideas. So thank you for your generosity. Thank you for your wonderful insights. Let's try and get together in a few months' time to really reassess things, because the world is changing and we need to get on board and make sure that we harness these new technologies for the benefit of humanity. I think that's the message I want to leave you with. So thank you so much, and thank you to all the contributors in the whole of this series. There have been 8 of these sessions. It's been wonderful, and we hope to be able to publish this discussion in some way in a forthcoming book. So thank you so much, everyone. And
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.